I tell you what, I am not a happy camper this morning. I know a lot of people are broiling in the U.S. right now. We're out here on the coast of California, and it's beautiful, unbelievable, beautiful days, perfect days. But I'm not a happy camper at all. I woke up this morning seeing my freedom. Freedom is coming for us, and not a minute too soon either. But in doing so, we're looking back retrospectively on the world and in material existence, and oh boy, you see how terrible it really has been. What a sham it is. Complete fraud. It's an attempt to simulate reality. It's like a cheap, junky piece of junk, really. Everything's disintegrating here. Every last thing is disintegrating. And I get irked, you know, at some spiritual teachers, the traditions that don't really go at it full bore. I'll tell you this, the teaching right now is the best it's ever been, because the situation now is the worst it's ever been. And we have no more time to fool around with niceties. There are people who say we're going to, you know, be able to build a beautiful world here. Really? Who's going to keep patching the roads as they disintegrate? Who's going to keep replacing the plumbing as they disintegrate? Who's going to keep putting on a new roof on our houses? Who among us can afford to keep maintaining our homes as everything we have now is junk? It disintegrates. The quality of consumer goods, everything is deteriorating. As somebody who's in the field of construction and taking care of everything, I can tell you for sure that it's just been a complete drastic falling apart of the quality of everything. Who can afford to maintain their homes? What are we talking about here? Saying we're entering into a beautiful age and that we can have a beautiful, peaceful earth, etc. What are they talking about? They have no idea what they're talking about, to tell you the truth. Material existence is an attempt to simulate multidimensional reality. Reality is not based on energy. It's not based on matter or form at all. Nothing disintegrates in reality. There's no need to replace anything. Nothing deteriorates. You can morph everything, but but you're dealing with essence. Okay, I buy trash cans, plastic trash cans. 3 years, they're completely disintegrated, falling apart. UV rays of the sun have wiped them out. Every last tool I buy, it's plastic. There's some weak parts up. Weak links in a chain everywhere. You know whatever you buy, you're going to have to replace it very soon. Who can afford to keep replacing everything around them? Only the rich people who are selling us this junk can afford to do that. It used to be my grandmother, she'd buy something, it was something for life, and it lasted her entire life. And even in my lifetime, you'd buy something you expected to last at least 20 years. If not 30, buy a transistor radio. I still had transistor radios from my youth that'll last you 30 years. You buy a radio now, it lasts you 3 years if you're lucky. Sometimes less than that. We buy expensive radios for construction sites, and sometimes they break before you, as soon as you get them out of the box, they don't even work. Every last thing in this world is junk, cheap. The whole, like I'm assembling some tools. The bolts that I'm tightening with a wrench, the bolt just twists and breaks in half. Never, ever had that happen to me before. And I'm talking to other people, and I say, oh yeah, it happens all the time now. You can't tighten it too much, it'll just break. Pot metal. The quality of metal has deteriorated. Quality of everything has deteriorated. When I buy anything, I'm looking at it and I realize, this isn't going to last more than several years. It's absolute junk. The design is terrible. I mean, you buy a pair of garden clippers, easily can design a pair of garden clippers to last a lifetime. And I don't know how many garden clippers I've been through, maybe 30 pair, you know, in the last 20 years. Who can afford to keep buying all this stuff? Nobody except the people who are selling this junk, who are getting rich off selling people junk. They're the only people who can afford. You know, the people who are talking about a new world here in materiality, etc., There are people who can afford others, pay others to fix everything for them, because every last thing in this world needs to be fixed. A roof lasts how long? 20 years. Plumbing is deteriorating. You have to replace your plumbing. Car that you buy, you have to replace the tires constantly. Everything has to be replaced constantly. Who has the money to pay for all this? Only people who have figured out how to game the system have enough money to insulate themselves from the complete deterioration of everything on this planet. And the rest of us are just slipping into destitution. I can't afford to replace this computer. I mean, my MP3 player is now officially broken. Lasted, what, 2 or 3 years? Kaput. Telephones have to be replaced constantly. Who has the money to do that? I sure don't. I think, what is it, like a third of the people in this country don't have any savings at all. I have no savings, nothing, because I've had to constantly replace everything that keeps breaking. And, you know, these gurus who talk about how working is overrated and stuff like that. Really? Are they not traveling along roads that have to be constantly maintained? I used to have to maintain roads. I used to pitch asphalt off of trucks, hot asphalt, and pave all the potholes, fill potholes. Roads are constantly deteriorating. And there are people out there constantly having to fix these roads. And I tell you, that work is no fun at all. Okay, are these gurus not in homes with plumbing or in buildings with plumbing? That plumbing, I tell you, I know plumbers. And they're constantly having to fix things. They have to throw out water heaters. They're having to throw out sinks. They're having to throw out toilets. Replace every last darn piece of plumbing in your home nonstop. I don't see the gurus doing that, do you? The roofs over their heads. I see roofers coming out, tearing roofs off of homes. And I know roofers. You think that's easy work? It's extremely difficult work. You have to replace these roofs. They disintegrate. Okay? Unless you put slate up, which who can afford slate? And even then, you have to repair because it keeps slipping off. The rich people, their homes, they're disintegrating. We have to go in constant maintenance for their homes. It's very expensive. Maintaining a home is becoming prohibitively expensive. So everything these gurus, the whole infrastructure that they're utilizing, that all has to be kept up, maintained by an army of workers who do this hellish work. So what are they talking about work is overrated? Yeah, it's overrated if you don't have to do it. But those people who have slipped down and they're in the maintenance class of trying to maintain this facade here of multidimensionality, which is all this is a fake, attempt to fake multidimensionality, to fake the riches of spiritual life. It's an attempt to fake it. I have some shirts, linen shirts. These shirts will last a lifetime. And that's all I need. Give me 10 linen shirts to last a lifetime. And yet here we are, fashion cycles, people just constantly buying different clothes. I used to get a pair of shoes to last me 20 years. And if the heels wear down, replace the heel. Okay. Now you pay $80, you better buy a pair of tennis shoes, they're no good in a year. Even quality shoes only last you a couple years. It's completely insane. Who can afford to continuously buy everything on a cycles of 2 or 3 years? Okay. The gurus who go about the streets in the marketplaces, you know what? All the electrical lighting there so they can see. Who keeps up all that lighting? Who replaces all the lights? I go into the store, I buy this new fluorescent bulbs. They say they're going to last 10 years. That's their advertising. They last 2 years. I've already replacing them. And I talk to the salesperson. I know people who are the middlemen, you know, the merchants. And I'm an honest person. They know it. And I just say, hey, look, this thing only lasted a couple of years. They say it's last 10. And they say, yeah, I know. Its advertising is completely false. It only lasts 2 or 3 years. We're paying $8 for a light bulb now that's going to last 2 years. And they're telling us, you know, 20,000 hours or 40,000 hours, 10 years of use. Nonsense. Every last single thing I put in a house, I can tell you it's not going to last. Plastic disintegrates. Okay, the quality of metal, the planet's resources have been used up. Who is talking about some, you know, building this great new civilization on this planet? They're absolutely nuts. And they're surrounded by people who have gamed the system, who can afford to pay others to maintain everything. I've had to maintain my yard my entire life. I've 50 years of working in the yard. When I was young, we never had a gardener. I've done everything. I can tell you, garden work is hell. If you have to do all your own garden work, it is hell. Just trying to maintain your yard. But you know what? Almost everybody where I live, everyone has a gardener. They can afford it. Okay? So, they don't feel the hell of it. I tell you, I put in irrigation systems and everywhere. I tell you, they'll have to be replaced. All the drip system wears out. You have to replace all of this stuff. The pots break. You have to replace all of that stuff. Everything now. None of it lasts. So the cycle of replacement is becoming quicker and quicker and quicker. And that all falls on the shoulders of those who don't have the money to pay somebody else to do it. So this grandiose delusion that we're going to build a better planet, to build a better world, that is false teaching. Okay, I'm giving you the right teaching. We are going to graduate into multidimensionality, into functioning in essence. Okay, we're going to completely leave materiality behind altogether. That is the only salvation there is. There's no such thing as salvation in material existence. Because everything here is disintegrating. Everything. And there are those who are clever and shrewd and ruthless who have given a measure of insulation from that because they have the money and the means to pay others to take care of all this stuff, you know. And I personally know people many people who have that. They have drivers, they have chefs, they have house cleaners, they have gardeners, and on and on and on and on and on. They don't have to deal with any of this stuff. And for them, they say, gee, you know, life is a bowl of cherries. But if you remember, we're all one. If one brother is suffering, we're all suffering. Whatever burden we place on someone else, that burden is on us as well. I always say, if there's one person sick in the world, I'm sick. If there's one person dying in the world, I'm dying. If there's one person slaving on a hot asphalt road, I'm slaving too. If there's someone out there in the sun picking cotton so we can follow the latest fashion cycles, I'm out there picking cotton too. That's a fact. So it's totally delusional to talk about making this world a wonderful place. This world, all of material existence is literally our attempt to create a separate reality, to separate from the multidimensional functioning in essence and idea and manifestation, a glorious reality that we were created to function in. And instead we wanted to be prime creators, and we have imagined this separate reality, and it's energy and materiality, and everything here is impermanent, everything breaks. You know, it's easy for the spiritualist sects in the past. They had a begging bowl made out of hardwood. That begging bowl would last generations. Okay, hundreds of years. They had a staff. They had a shawl made out of fine wool or something. That shawl would last them 50 years or a lifetime. Okay? And they'd walk barefoot in a loincloth. They didn't have to. They weren't in a cycle of replacement at all. So it's easy for them to. And they walk along a dirt pass in a jungle. Easy for them to think, you know, I can just sit in this cave. This cave will be here for 100,000 years or more. And so they didn't feel the bite of impermanence quite like we're feeling it right now. Excuse me. But the bite of impermanence has become intolerable right now. Who can afford to build a new home, for instance? We can't even afford to maintain the homes we have. The cycles of junk have become so terrible that so many people have no savings, no retirement. They've maxed out their credit cards just to try to maintain their home, their living, their cars. Everything on a car breaks, the light bulb goes out in several years. It's incredible. My truck, the on the tailgate, the handle to you know, undo the tailgate and let the tailgate down. It's made of cheap plastic. It breaks. Cost me $80, $40, and $80 to replace it, that part. Plus time, loss of time and work. I've had to replace it 3 times. Last time I had it replaced, I opened it up and it just let the tailgate drop. It just snapped. First time, brand new part, just snapped. Couldn't even handle the vibration of the tailgate dropping. So I just don't leave it off now. Everything is like that. The plastic is becoming cheaper and cheaper. This is an expense. These are expensive work truck. It's all plastic. It's not metal anymore. Whatever metal there is pot metal anyway. Everything is breaking down faster and faster and faster. We get stuff, tools that get them out of the box, use them for one day, they break. We had like a $300 nailer that, brand new, $380, I think. First day on the job, it broke. The trigger mechanism was complete junk. Complete junk. This is supposed to be a quality brand. You can't even get quality tools anymore. And so this la-di-da lifestyle of people, of gurus who are surrounded by professionals who have been able to game the system and get enough money to insulate themselves, thinking, spiritual teacher, just tell us that, you know, we're going to be able to live the life O'Reilly forever. Nonsense. First of all, the maintenance class should all just ascend. Okay? I'm tired. I'm not going to do any more maintenance for the world. You know, the honey-do list is extended infinitely, right? My life, my destiny is not to be engaged in the endless honey-do list of simply fixing stuff that continually breaks. Every day, something breaks. My life is consumed with fixing stuff that's breaking, or now going out and buying new stuff. There's new tool stores now. It's entirely junk, okay, from you know where. And you go in, you buy super cheap, buy a tool. Now, I know owner of a tool store, quality stuff. I talk with him a lot, and I asked him about this place, and he has people come in with tools to repair. He repairs tools. And he just says, look, the repair cost is going to be more than if you just went out and bought a new tool from there. And so he says, I tell everybody, you buy this junk, and it breaks in under a year. All you can do is just go throw it away and go buy a new tool. That's literally where we're at right now. You buy, you know, a tool, a sander for like $80. He says the good sanders will cost you $250, but they'll last maybe 10 years or something. People are buying these sanders for, you know, $60, $80. They last a year. They break. It's too expensive to fix them. They just throw it away and buy a new one. That is literally where we're at now. I know old people have tools. They've had tools their whole life. I look at their tool shed, all their shovels, all their picks, everything they have. They bought it one time. They still have it in great condition. They just use a grinder to sharpen it up. All their tools, they're still using them. They've been using them for 50 years. Okay, the cycle of replacing stuff is getting faster and faster and faster. We replace our phones. I know. Like the phone that we used to have, the desk phone with the handle and the dial thing. Those things were built to last 50 years. Now our phones last, what, a couple years? They fall apart. The replacement batteries are cheap. Everything we have, the replacement cycle is getting faster and faster. And the honey-do list is getting more and greater and greater and greater and greater. Just to try and maintain everything. Even the quality stuff is junk these days. My grandmother, she bought one thing and it lasted her lifetime. And she spent her retirement age. Once she retired, she just cruised the world because she had her savings. She didn't have to keep buying stuff or replacing stuff. She just spent her time traveling the whole world on cruise ships. She didn't have a good job. She wasn't rich. She was just a middle-class clerk. And yet she could retire at 65 and spend the next 30 years traveling the world. And yet how many of us who are middle class clerks can dream of that, can actually do that? It's ridiculous. We cannot. we're never going to be able to retire. But I'll tell you, the good news is we are not going to retire. We're going to ascend. Because multidimensionality, that is now pouring into this planet and awakening us to multidimensionality and realizing we can leave this fraud behind. Material existence is a fraud, and we are seeing it right now, and I'm speaking up again about it. And those teachers who are giving us this pie-in-the-sky belief that somehow staying on this planet and we can create a beautiful, peaceful world here, that is nonsense. Who's going to pave all the roads? Who's going to go out and dig all that stuff, deliver the asphalt, you know, keep the paving equipment up to snuff, pave all the roads, then maintain every last darn thing that is made? Everything has to be maintained. Everything gets old, has to be demoed, has to be hauled to the dump, has to be recycled. Everything. Who's going to do all that so you can prance around in your fine clothes, pretending that the world is your oyster? It's not honest, it's dishonest. Because every last person in this world, they're one with you. And their labor, their manual labor. Okay, all the manual labor. I work among people, you know, manual laborers. I see all the labor they're doing. Guys digging ditches. Every last thing that is, you know, put underground. All the plumbing, all the electricity. Everything's put underground. All those people are digging ditches. The irrigation systems for everyone's house. Those are people who are doing manual labor with picks. Some digging hammers, whatever. It's all manual labor still going on everywhere. It's a delusion. The upper class, the upper middle classes, the people who have money, are just living this delusion, and it's running out. We're running out of time. Replacement cycle is catching everybody up. So only the very rich can insulate themselves. They have to get richer and richer, which means you have to scam people more and more and more. You have to keep selling them more and more junk. And so you're going to have a very poor... Everyone's, the middle class is slipping into poverty. I can't afford to replace anything that I have anymore. I've spent all my money just trying to replace, trying to keep up with the replacement cycle. Cannot do it anymore. What is this talk about building a wonderful world? Really? We're running out of resources. Rare metals. The quality of metal, quality of everything is deteriorating. Unbelievably. Like in the world of music, we know like compressor, analog stuff, all the equipment we used to have, the analog, ran on compression tubes. I don't know if I'm saying this right because it's been so long. But, you know, all the equipment we had was analog and ran on tubes. The metal from those tubes, you cannot get it anymore. The rare metals, the precious metals, the quality of the metals that went into those tubes that we used that gave this incredible, rich, powerful, beautiful sound. You can't even get it anymore at all. And then the solid state stuff, you can't get that at all. So now we've gone into this cheap digital stuff that sounds terrible in comparison to the analog. The wood that we have, you cannot get the quality of wood that we used to get. When you go into redwood now, it's all sapwood. Only the rich people can afford to buy all the good wood, redwoods over in China and Japan. Okay, they buy it directly from the people who own the forest. They buy it directly. They pay a premium price for it. The wood we get in the U.S. now, the redwood, is junk. It's sapwood. You put that in the ground, it's going to rot. We demo redwood all the time. I just took down a redwood fence here in the house here. Redwood fence is 100 years old. A lot of that redwood is still perfectly good. Because why? There's no sapwood at all. Tight grain redwood. The redwood now you put in, it's white. It's all sapwood. It's not going to last. It's going to rot in 10 years' time. And then you have to replace it. I know, because I spend my time replacing stuff for people. You know, we spend our time replacing stuff, demoing stuff that's rotting, it's finished. I go to the dump, just full of junk. Landfills are choking because everything is disintegrating. I wonder if the gurus are sitting there, you know, giving their satsang, are aware. Why don't they go to a landfill? I go to a landfill every day. I really do. And I'm there seeing all the junk. That's real satsang. Okay, I call that real satsang. Because that awakens you more than anything. It awakens you to the nature of this planet, nature of the world. I'd say the guru should hold satsang in a landfill and just see what ends, where everything ends up, and seeing the absolute junkiness of everything. There's no more quality. You can't get quality anymore. Not really. I tried. I spent a lot of money on trying to get quality. It's not quality anymore. Even quality stuff falls apart now. And it's systemic. It's completely systemic. No matter how bad the quality is, there's plastic parts. There's some weak link that's going to break on you. Repair shops are going out of business. Even with the highest quality stuff, German-made stuff, the repair shops, they're going out of business because everyone's buying cheap junk, just throwing the tools away. And the stuff that they're the high-quality tools, they're breaking down too much. People say that's too expensive to keep repairing this stuff, and it is. Say, I could just, why spend $300 repairing a quality saw when you can buy a new one for $450? Except the new one's only going to last you 3 years, and little stuff's going to keep breaking on it. You talk to anybody who really does the dirty work in this world, and they'll tell you what's going on. And that's awakening us. It's awakened me. That's the ultimate satsang. The ultimate satsang is to do the dirty work in this world. It's not to sit there, you know, I don't want to criticize people too much, but I'm just doing real talk here, real rant here. A lot of those ladies that go to satsang, you know, they're upper middle class. Not all, but a lot of them. And they just want to have some spirituality, hang out and laugh with the guru, etc. Come on. If you want real satsang, do the dirty work in the world. That's why in the past the gurus, they would give their top disciples, they'd say, go work in a graveyard and dig graves. Be a grave digger. Okay? Be a grave digger. You'll find out what life is. They give them the crap jobs. Go be a sweep the streets. You know, but things are getting even worse now because nothing lasts at all. And our lives are choked with junk. We spend a lot, my life spent getting rid of junk, people's junk. And our yards are all fancy now, and we got to spend all this time and effort trying to keep our yards up. The plants are getting worse. I've noticed the quality of the plants, the flowers, everything is worse quality, weaker quality of plants. Everything is superficial here. The quality of our food. The quality of our food. The only people who can afford to get good quality food is wealthy people. You have to get organic everything. Even organic food is getting contaminated. It's not good quality. The rest of the people are eating horrible junk. It's contaminated. This whole planet is contaminated. Why? We're trying to simulate multidimensional reality by having riches. You know, I used to go to thrift stores. I tried to simulate it, and I'd buy 20 shirts a day. I used to go every day and I'd buy, you know, 3 pairs of shoes, $1 for a pair of shoes, you know, 50 cents for shirts. And I used to have hundreds and hundreds, even thousands of shirts. And I had hundreds of pairs of shoes, and I'd wear, you know, 5 different outfits a day. And I was trying to simulate multidimensionality by having just endless choices, you know. I literally had, you know, hundreds of thousands of different choices as far as outfits. I had hundreds of hats. I had no space to put all this stuff in. I literally could, you know, put on endless types of outfits. Endless. And I just wanted to simulate being able to just change rapidly my experiencing, my look, everything. And then the wealthy people, they actually get new stuff. And I tried to do that too. You can't afford it. But think of the carbon footprint. that we're of all of this. The reason why the carbon footprint in the world is so extreme is because we are trying to simulate reality here. And that requires us to continuously produce more and more and more and more and more and more and more. I know people have 3, 4, 5 homes. Really. One home is in a, you know, with the yacht harbor, with yachts there. They fly among to the different homes. They have multiple cars at every home. Multiple. I know people who switch cars every year, every 2 years. I grew up, there's this businessman, got a new Cadillac every single year. A couple, actually, one for the wife. Every year, a new Cadillac. Okay. There are people here I know, they get expensive cars, $100,000 cars. They switch them out every couple years. They have 3, 4, they have cars in storage. We have people, we have to rent storage places now just to store all our stuff. We've got so much stuff. Why? We're trying to simulate reality. We're trying to simulate multidimensional reality. Reality is infinite riches, but it's not energy. It's not matter. It's not form. It's not energy. It doesn't disintegrate. It doesn't turn into garbage. This planet, we've used it up trying to simulate reality. We have used it up. The planet is dying. The carbon footprint of everybody is out of control. And the people who are complaining about the carbon footprint, for the most part, you know, they're wealthy. They're jetting around to the different homes. They're taking vacations all over the planet. They're going to conferences all over the place. Yeah, most people can barely afford gas to get to work. They can't afford to jet to a conference. Ranting, you know. Let me see if I can... Light is changing on me here. Everything changes, doesn't it? Now I look like an Indian pundit or something. Yeah. In the pre-industrial societies, you know, it was a little different. But we're at a spot now where the full impact of our folly is hitting us. And that's why you have an advisor such as myself who is speaking in ways that is more adamant than it has been in the past. And I can go just extremely adamant. Maybe you're not used to it. But the time has come for this type of talk. I am telling you that material existence is a sham. It's a con. It's self-deception. We are trying to create a separate reality. And we are trying to simulate multidimensional reality of essence in materiality. And it's killing everybody. I mean, I wake up in the morning and the stress is unbearable because I realize everything around me is going to break. I don't have the money or the time, the money, or the energy to replace it anymore. So I'm going to slip down into poverty and destitution. I can't keep up. You have to have a lot of energy. You know why? The only reason why people are keeping up is because they're drinking caffeine. I think over 90% of the women in the world drink caffeine, use caffeine every day. I don't know about the men. Maybe it's higher. The only way you have to keep driving yourself relentlessly. And for me, I can't take caffeine because it causes my whole system to shut down. My intestines, my whole flow of my body gets paralyzed. And I'll die if I drink caffeine. So I can't use stimulants. So I cannot get up in the morning and drink a cup of coffee. Most people, the only way they can keep going is drinking coffee. And they get up in the morning, get that jolt of energy, and they go out there and they try to produce, get enough money just to desperately keep up. And then the shrewd people, they're managing the whole situation. And but that's becoming less and less. You got this, you have a wealthy, high class of wealthy people, and the rest of people are slipping down into destitution. And they're propping themselves up through stimulants. You get those energy drinks now. People are constantly now having to take those energy drinks just to keep going. And if you can't take those artificial energy, we're running on artificial energy. The planet's been doing that for quite some time. So the only solution is to junk the whole thing. I'm absolutely ready to junk the whole thing. The whole ridiculous detour into illusion, into mirage, into fake reality. Ready to junk it all. Let the whole world burn. Let it burn. It should. I tell you that because we are literally surrounded. We're drowning in materiality. Everything that we're making and doing is going to break on us. And our whole lives are going to be consumed with trying to fix everything that's continually breaking. It's dilapidating. I mean, the infrastructure of America is crumbling. We don't even have the money to replace it. The bridges. Everything is crumbling. Our debt is unsustainable. The whole thing is unsustainable. And there are some people, such as myself, who realize this very clearly and say, folks, the party's over. Turn out the lights, the party is over. And fortunately, the party is over. This planet is going to be melted down when the magnetic superwave from the center of the galaxies comes in and affects the sun. The sun is going to heat up. And this planet is going to melt down. It's over. And before that happens, we're going to ascend back into multidimensional functioning. Those who are aware and are willing. I'm willing to go right now. I can't keep maintaining everything. My life is consumed by going to the store, going to Home Depot or, someplace, buying stuff. Putting it on credit cards, not able to pay the credit cards, trying to keep the whole thing going, and then trying to keep everybody else's life, because everyone else's life is my life. So I see somebody else suffering. I figure that's my responsibility to keep them going too. I can't keep everybody going. I can't keep this charade going. Material existence is a charade. It's a fake. It's a hypothetical, plausible scenario. It doesn't work. Everything falls apart. It's all impermanent. We have all this fancy stuff. It's all junk. And I guess there's this whole class of what we're taught in this world is entitlement. There's a class of entitlement who feel they're simply entitled to have a high standard of living, and everybody else is supposed to make sure that they have that. The princess complex. And there are those who simply, really, when you go to school, what I saw was that people simply learn entitlement. And those who are most ruthless in that learn it the best. And they then go up to higher positions in social positions where they simply impose their entitlement on others. Others who are fairer, less ruthless, more honest, not willing to lie, cheat, steal, cut corners, they sink down and end up doing the garbage work like I'm doing now. I'm not willing to function the way that entitlement class functions. If I want to produce something, I want it to last forever. I want to give people the very best so it never breaks on them. If it breaks, it's my fault. I have people of ethics and quality. If they sell me something and it breaks, they say, no, it's my fault. I'm going to have to eat that. I'm going to have to pay for that. You don't get that anymore. Rare do you meet those people. Those people are going out of business. People with high ethics, etc., they go out of business. Because everything they sell keeps breaking. And they say, well, gosh, I really got to stand behind what I sell you. They can't afford to do that anymore. So people literally have to treat one another as if we're disposable, we're dispensable. We're all disposable. We're all serving the princess complex of entitlement of those who feel that the world owes them a living, that they're entitled to live in luxury and carefree existence. That's their birthright. And if they don't have that, the rest of us are somehow guilty because we're not providing it for them. Now those people are absolutely ruthless. There's a ruthless mentality. They put the guilt on us. We're all guilty because we're not providing a carefree life for these aristocratic entitlement people. You know, guess what? Let's all ascend. And if there are those people who still want to think that they want to stay in material existence because they're entitled to be taken care of in material existence, well, guess what? They're going to have to take care of themselves. And they're going to find out the hard way. They're going to go back to a primitive existence. I'm not going to keep taking care of people in existence here. I'm entitled to dwell in reality. I'm entitled to live under God's laws and God's rules. But there's no disintegration, there's no impermanence, there's no death, there's no sickness. I'm entitled to live that way. That's my lifestyle. I'm entitled to that lifestyle. I'm not going to stay here on a planet and try to give people a carefree existence in this world where everything disintegrates. You end up being a slave. You end up being enslaved. I'm enslaved. I'm an indentured servant right now. And all of you are falling down into that place too if you want to keep your integrity. You want to keep your love for everybody. You know, I see somebody, homeless person, I feel that's me. That's me there. I don't see myself as different than them. So the lowest of the low, that is me. We're one. We're not separate beings. If anyone is suffering in this world, I'm suffering. So all these people who have this entitlement complex and put the guilt on everybody else that we're not serving their entitlement complex, all the suffering that the people go through, the slaves, that's my suffering. I want a world. I want to dwell in a place where nobody's suffering, where we all have everything. Where we all entitled to have everything, and we do have everything. That's reality. That's the way reality is. In reality, everyone has everything. Nobody has to slave for anybody else, because nobody's in poverty. There's no disintegration. There's no breaking down. There are no estates where somebody has to mow the lawn every week, fertilize the lawn, put pesticide on the lawn, deal with all the sprinkling and irrigation problems. There's no place I used to spend time in the Salinas Valley where I'd see these farm workers. They work all night. It's 24 hours a day there. Okay, their crews. The work they do, I saw the irrigation people all day long. They're moving aluminum irrigation pipe, soaked, wearing this heavy clothing. The wind is howling there. I just sit there and I just look at them and I say, oh my God, that's me who's doing that work. I'm doing all the agricultural work. We all are. We're all one. And the food, fancy food we eat, we go into these organic markets and we eat this food and stuff. Agricultural workers are slaving away to produce all that. I've been there, I've watched the pickers pick all the food. I watch these people labor every day in the sun, harvesting the crops, planting the crops. Families, you know. Migrant farm workers, that's me, that's you. You can't insulate yourself in some castle from that. It's delusional if you think they can. Because then you use guilt, you have to use all these egoic tactics, try to make yourself feel better. Ascension is the only answer. Choosing multidimensional functioning is the only answer. That's why I say this, the only real loving thing to do on this planet is to take the spiritual path of clarification and awareness and choose what you're really entitled to, which is reality. And show your brothers, sisters, that this is available to them. That's the only way you could get free of guilt. Show them a life where nothing dies, where everything is permanent. And you have access to endless, infinite options. If you want a new house, you just manifest a new house, but there's nothing in the house that will disintegrate. And if you get tired of it, you manifest another one. If you want to remodel your kitchen, you manifest the remodel. But the one you had before is still flawless. Nothing ever goes wrong with it. You know, here we build these beautiful new homes. they get called back a couple years later and everything's cracking because the land is settling. The land settles, the land moves. All the tile is cracking, you know, the grout is cracking. But in reality, there's none of that. Everything is perfectly flawless, just the way you manifest it, just the way you wanted it. Even if you want a grunge look, that grunge look is flawless. It's not going to change. There's nobody slaving for anybody else in reality. There's nobody needs to cut your lawn. Okay? Nobody needs to cut your hedge, trim all your plants. You manifest whatever you want. When you want something else, you manifest that. You choose that. That is reality. And you are weaving together infinite riches. And nobody has to maintain. Nobody has to come in and replace your plumbing. Replace your toilet. Your toilet doesn't clog up. You don't even have a toilet because you don't have a physical form. You may have a light body form. Or you don't need one. You don't need a body to experience. Experiencing is not based on a body. You don't need a body to experience. It's an absolute sham. We think that somehow without a body, we won't be experiencing. Really, when we go to sleep and dream, we're just imagining we have a body to do it. Imagining we're experiencing. You don't need a body to experience. You are spirit, your essence. Essence experiences essence. People love antiques, you know, they see something that's lasted 100 years and they just say, oh, I love this so much. I love golf because you can get a pair of golf clubs and really should last a lifetime. The golf course there, you know, is just unchanging. You go to a golf course the same as it was 10 years ago, 20 years ago. Some of these golf courses have been there for, you know, 100 years, 200 years. And you can use the same equipment, you can use old set of irons, they still work great. It's very simple, very basic. It feels like, wow, you know, this stuff is not disintegrating on me. People are desperate for that feeling of something that lasts. But nothing lasts in this world. And nobody's addressing this. I'm so disappointed in the spiritual teachers of this time, you know. They're not adamant enough. We live in hell here, okay? This is not a joke. The idea that somehow we can be happy here is crazy. Really? It's only on the highest level. We can be happy here when we shift it into multidimensional awareness. Okay, that's the truth. And we're not really happy here. We're now aware of multidimensionality and that which is imperishable. That's why we're happy. You know, they should make that clearer. Again, in any satsang, you rent a building, okay? You're having a satsang in a building. Somebody built that building. Somebody got all the raw materials and manufactured every part of that building. Somebody just trucked all those materials on roads. Somebody built those roads. Somebody's maintaining those roads. The truckers had to have gasoline. Somebody's getting oil out of the ground, refining the oil, distributing the oil. Somebody has a gas station. They're pumping the gas. You know, they have the gas available. The truckers have to put the gas in their truck. They got to get new tires. Just the massive infrastructure to truck the raw materials, the sheet rock, the wood, the lumber, everything to a distribution center. Somebody has to go there and pick up all that material. Somebody has to make the blueprint. Somebody has to build all that material, nail everything, get the nails from everywhere. It's an incredible, huge endeavor just to build any building. And somebody has to put in the air conditioning, the heating, the water, the plumbing, the electricity. on and on and on. The paint has got to be painted, the carpet, and all that stuff is deteriorating. It's going to need to be repainted in 20 years or 10 years. The paint is junk now. I talk to painters. It's junk. I go into a paint store. I talk to the owners of a paint store. They say the paint these days, I mean, they talk about a guy. I just talked to an owner of a paint store. They said, there's an old guy. They went to this old guy, and he was a painter. And he went to this old guy's house, and the guy said, I want you to repaint this. And he said, here's the paint. And they had this paint. Paint was 50 years old. He said, yeah, I store all my paint upside down and keep it, and it's just fine. And the painter mixed the paint up. It's still good. 50 years old, the paint is still good. And he used it, and it covered like a dream. Nowadays, the paint, you get new paint, they change the brands every 2 years. They change the formulations. It's junk. It's not going to last. I mean, you paint your house. It used to be you paint your house, you figure it's last 50 years. Nowadays, how long does a paint job last? 10 years? You're going to have to repaint your house. It's all fading. Everything's fading. The carpet we have now is disintegrating. It used to be you get like a Persian carpet, high-quality Persian carpet. Now, you have people have those carpets in their homes, wealthy people, and they got them. Those carpets last hundreds of years. Carpet we get now, it's going to be torn out. You know, it's junk in 15 years, 10 years. So you're holding satsang in this place where everything is disintegrating. Everything's going to have to be replaced. The water you're getting, you know, so difficult to get good water now. The bathrooms, everything, the fixtures, they're junk. The rubber is junk. The gaskets are junk. Those are going to have to be replaced. The whole thing, the whole building you're holding satsang in is deteriorating and falling apart. And it's going to have to be paid. People have to pay to fix that. So the rent, you know, has to be jacked up. So you have to, just to use it, you have to have more income, more income, more income. And I go on and on and on. The air we're breathing, planet's disintegrating. You're holding satsang on a planet that's disintegrating. We're using up all the rare metals on this planet. Running out of them. Peak oil, all this oil has already peaked. We're on a disintegrating planet. We're holding satsang on a disintegrating planet in a building that is disintegrating. In a room that is disintegrating. Talking to bodies that are disintegrating. So you better be telling them in satsang that this world isn't real. It is not real. It's fake. It's not your home. Don't talk about making a home on this planet. It's not your home. Material, the dance of energy is not your home. Your home is in essence and being and manifestation and multidimensionality. This here is a detour into fear. It is a dream. That's what they should be telling him. And you can wake up right now to your eternal life, your eternal truth, your eternal life is still with us. This body, this suit is disintegrating. This flesh is falling apart. It's exhausted. It's not your life. This world is not your home. Never has been, never will be. And you better be telling them that you can do it right now. Awakening to multidimensionality, you can do it right now. You're entitled to it. You're 100% entitled to do it right now, today. And that you can reassure everybody else that they can do it right now, today, too. Now, somebody is picking up all the garbage, okay? And I know those people who do it. Every morning, 2 a.m, somebody's getting up and they're picking up your garbage and hauling it off to the dump. And everywhere producing more and more garbage. It's incredible. Every week I think, you know what? I think this next week I'm not going to have any garbage. Just think about that in the past, how little garbage we had compared to now. It's just unbelievable. We need bigger and bigger bins for it. And the idea that somehow we can create this world that is all sustainable and all beautiful, nothing is going to fall apart, is a delusion, really? What about your plumbing? Even the copper pipe just is having problems with it. What the hell is going on with copper pipe? Copper, even the copper's not as good as it used to be. Even the wealthy people, their homes are disintegrating. They can't get the good quality stuff anymore. Quality is deteriorating everywhere. What are we going to do? We live on an island in thatch huts? A tan everywhere? Guess what? That all disintegrates too. The dream of some, you know, living on a desert, an island, tropical island, in palm frond huts, thatch huts and everything. Guess what? Those people live there, spend their lives replacing all of this. It's not an ideal existence. People are enslaved to hard labor, hard work. The whole dream that science gave us is somehow they're going to free us from this enslavement. No, it's only the wealthy people are insulating themselves from this, and even they are irritated by it. Yeah, a lot of people get new cars every 2-3 years. Who can afford that? So they don't have to deal. I mean, when they get rid of their car before the warranty expires, some problem, they bring it in, have, you know, warranty fix it. Those people can't afford to do that. The warranty runs out. They're getting destroyed by trying to, the costs of trying to repair their automobile. I have to go replace something. Said, well, we got to diagnose it. You know, $60. And then if we find out something wrong, well, we got to order a new part, a couple $100 maybe. I said, warranties, oh, 3-year warranty. Okay, I ran out. Broke. Windows don't work. Everything is like that. You know, when you get up in the morning, you're surrounded by something, everything is going to break. I'm going to drive my truck. I know everything on that truck is going to break. How can I afford to fix it? We got to replace it. Simply replace it. If you can't afford to keep replacing with new stuff, you're going to end up with old junky stuff, and your life is just going to deteriorate. You can't afford to keep up the pace of life. You can't afford to keep buying new technology constantly. But the way things are developing, if you can't afford, I mean, who can afford to keep replacing their printer every, how many printers have I gone through in my life? 20? And then you have to keep buying new ink for it, $50 a pop. And who can afford to keep printing stuff all the time? You have to have a very high, steady income to just keep up. It's a Ponzi scheme. Existence is really a Ponzi scheme. Okay? It really is. It is a Ponzi scheme, which is why you have this whole part of existence which is ceaselessly promoting more and more bodies. You got to bring more and more bodies in. So fertility goddess, you know, seducing more and more bodies, telling spirit, you got to produce more bodies. Why? To keep this whole Ponzi scheme going of existence. At the very top, you have these, you know, Ponzi scheme masters who are, you know, trying to keep the whole thing going. It's a Ponzi scheme. It's going to collapse. People say that God made existence. God didn't make existence. God didn't make this Ponzi scheme. We did. Spirit did, because we wanted to be prime creator. We wanted to forget what we are. And this forgetting of what we are is a Ponzi scheme. It keeps collapsing. It keeps collapsing. It keeps collapsing. And only the very ruthless seem to be functioning here. You talk to an honest business people, which I have people, they say, there's no such thing as an honest business person. You can't stay in business if you're honest, which is true. You cannot. I can't be a business person at all. I'm way too honest. It's impossible. I couldn't even get my feet off the ground at all. I see like something, if something breaks, I see something breaks, I'll stop. I'll say, here, let me help you fix it, you know. Yeah, the people who are succeeding are just dumping all the work on everybody else. They're not stopping to fix stuff. They're saying, that's somebody else's problem. People that are getting ahead are just pushing the problems on everybody else. You know, crap rolls downhill. And if you really are conscientious, you end up being the one who is fixing everybody else's problems and probably doing it for free. Or for a pittance. Because those who are, you know, aggressive and ruthless on caffeine, they say, it's not my problem. I got to keep, you know, moving faster. Let somebody else deal with that. Something breaks, I'm not going to stop and worry about fix it. Somebody busted a mailbox recently, and they didn't even stop to leave a note. They just busted. Oh, what the heck? We're too busy. Gone. We ended up having to fix it, you know? Took a lot of time and effort there. Because we figured we're responsible, you know. We didn't do it, but we felt, you know, because we were working in the area that we couldn't prove who did it, although there's someone who did it. So if you're more conscientious you are, the more you slip down. The good don't succeed here in the Ponzi scheme. They're the ones who end up on the bottom. That's why Jesus said, blessed are the meek, the poor in spirit, they'll be saved. Because they realize the whole Ponzi scheme nature of existence. And be saved, meaning return to multidimensional functioning, return to unconditional love, return to reality. Those are the ones who say, to heck with this. To heck with this Ponzi scheme. I'm out of here, you know. And fortunately, the divine grace is coming in unprecedented style now. Because we are at a dead end on this planet. The Ponzi scheme is collapsing. And you're blessed if you see that. Right now, if you're poor, if you've got no savings, no retirement, you're barely clinging to a job or have no job, you got no retirement, you got maxed out credit cards, you can't afford your medication, you can't afford your bills. All that, you're blessed, actually. You are really blessed. Because when you start feeling multidimensionality, when you get that experience, you say, wow, this is great. I want this. What do I got to lose? I got nothing in this world. There's no chance of success in the future of this planet for many of us. No possibility. You have to be absolutely ruthless to succeed on this planet. And I tell you, the most ruthless people are those who pretend to be good. They're really ruthless. Because they cast a facade of goodness on others and get others to work for them. Saying, hey, we're going to create the kingdom here. You know, I've got this great plan. They're the worst of all. At least dishonest, ruthless people who are not pretending to be good. You know what? You talk to them and they'll admit it. They say, yeah, you know, I'm an SOB. That's true. I can talk to those people, you know. They'll admit it. They say, yeah, I cheat. I steal. I lie. I do all this dishonest stuff. Yeah, I do. I'm pretty terrible. I admit it, yeah. But the people who are pretending to be good, oh no, they're holier than thou. They're saving the planet. They're building the kingdom here. And if you're spiritual, you're supposed to be helping them. You're doing seva, you're doing service for them. You know? Yeah, the gurus who say, hey, you know, you're gonna save yourself 5 lifetimes by doing service for me. Just one day of service for me saves you lifetimes of effort. And so they get all this army of people doing free service for them, building their temples, building their luxury, and then they go around the world in designer clothing, have a vast wardrobe, thousands of shoes. They have an empire built on slave labor. And they're holier than thou. They're supposedly spiritual teachers. What nonsense. Spiritual teacher is someone that gives you the straight truth. This world is worth nothing. It is absolutely nothing. There's nothing here at all. And the attempt to have a whole lot of nothing is hell. Okay. This world is an enslavement. It's a Ponzi scheme. It's not real. It's imagination. It's pretending. It's a pretend world. It's a hypothetical world. It's a plausible world. It's not real. Our functioning here is we're flatliners. This is not life. It's death. We're not living. We're like zombies. We're like death zombies here. This isn't life that we have. I don't care how rich you are. Like I said, I was able to accumulate a wardrobe that would make the Duke of Windsor envious, because I wanted to see what it was like. It was hell. I wasn't happy. You know, pomp and circumstance, it's not going to make you happy. I guarantee you that. And the wealth that's been built up in this world has been built up on the backs of blood, sweat, and tears of slave labor. That's a fact. The cheap stuff, cheap junk that we go buy is being built on by slave labor. And they say, well, you know, they're getting more than they used to. Yeah, that's right. Because before, just subsistence in this world was built on slave labor. You know? Did God, we're supposed to thank God for creating all that? God didn't create any of this. God didn't create the material realm where we run out of resources, we're running out of precious metals, rare earth minerals. Why do you think we're in Afghanistan? Because there's some rare earth minerals in those mountains. A lot of very rare minerals are there. But there's very few places in the world where these rare minerals are using technology. You can get them. We're running out of them. Globe is running out of resources. Do you really think God created human beings, flesh, and put them on a planet where they're going to run out of resources? How crazy is that? Did not. Reality is exactly the same way it's always been. Imperishable, incorruptible, infinite endlessness, total riches, endless riches, invulnerable, eternal, total access to everything, because all you have to do is your intention. Say, this is, I want to experience this, and there it is for you. You want to experience the finest palace there ever was, instantly there's that palace. And you're experiencing it. It's flawless. It's an essence. There's no plumbing problems. You know, these great rich aristocrats build all these great palaces. They crumble over time. You have to spend a fortune to maintain them. Or a fortune to restore them. And the gardens, the great gardens in the States, you know, sure, if you're wealthy and you're invited to those places, you say, wow, I've been to some incredible places, and you think I'm in paradise. Look how beautiful it all is. Well, you know what? I've been to places, I used to go every day, and every day there were gardeners there working every single day. Two, three, four, sometimes a whole gang of gardeners every day, every single day of the year. That's how it used to be on the estates. They have a crew of groundskeepers maintaining it. I mean, golf courses have a crew of groundskeepers maintaining the golf course every day. I've seen them. 4 a.m, before it's even a light. They have lights on their equipment so they can go out and mow the fairways, mow the greens, rake the bunkers, cut the holes in the greens for the pins. So when the golfers arrive, 7:30, wow, the course is like immaculate. Because there's a whole crew of groundskeepers working on it. And they're working on the irrigation systems of it too. Everything, constant maintenance, constant work. And that is life here. It'll always be life here. Who is it that is teaching that somehow we're supposed to set our sights on life here on this planet? Who is teaching that? Why? Get a taste of multidimensionality in this world. You see, huh? What a joke. What a funny joke. We will look back on this and say, laugh. We will have a really good laugh. That we ever thought for a second that somehow this was our home. This is how we're supposed to function. What an insane idea that was. You're not supposed to to remain dwelling in a realm, a material realm. You're supposed to dwell in the spiritual realm, where nothing corrupts, where moths don't eat, where nothing is corruptible. That's why gold is the symbol of the spiritual realm. That's why people like gold and diamonds, you know, it reminds them something that doesn't corrupt. You know, I look at this beautiful yard, but you know, I've worked like a slave on it, and it terrifies me every time I go out. Now, do you think I should be happy? I have so much, you know, beauty around me. No, it terrifies me because I know I have to maintain it all, and it's hell to maintain it, and I'm getting too old and I'm tired to do it. I can't afford a gardener. It's hell. So it's like you, 1 minute you're looking at this paradise, and then suddenly it flip-flops into hell because you realize, oh my gosh, if I don't maintain it, it's all going to go to pieces on me. Plus, I have to, you know, check the drip system, everything all the time, because the tubes pull apart, you know, in heat. They disintegrate. The plastic gets brittle, loses its pliability, and, you know, you have to keep inspecting everything. Stuff is dying. Is this getting enough water? Is this that? So it ends up becoming an enormous burden. A huge burden. People get these beautiful homes and they think they're going to be happy. And what they feel is they feel it's an enormous burden. And another thing I'll tell you is people who build these beautiful homes, when they finish building it, they go, ah, I want to build another one. The joy is in the building of it. And then the maintaining of it. Ah, I don't want to maintain it. I want to build it. Let me build another one. Or they say, I'm already bored with it. They don't want to really live in it. They want to remodel. Let's remodel it. Let's sell it. How many times you build a home, people 2 years time, they want to sell it. Because they want to experience multidimensionality. We all want to experience it. But we're deluded into thinking that this is reality, this world is our home. And so we keep trying to find some way to experience multidimensionality here. And for some people, that's flipping a home, getting a new home every 2 years, constantly moving. I know people are always moving, getting new cars, constantly updating their wardrobe. Constantly going out to restaurants every night. Constantly keeping a lifestyle. Change, 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 change. How much energy does that require? What if you get sick? What if you get tired? Of course these people are on caffeine. Of course they get sick. And they end up in a hospital. And run up $1 million worth of medical bills, which those people who try to keep themselves healthy end up paying for. This whole medical system, again, is a Ponzi scheme. So you have people who run themselves ragged, trying to chase after the end of the rainbow, and then their body starts falling apart, and they end up, you know, when they get older, they end up spending incredible millions of dollars in medical bills. And the healthy young people who, like myself, I work so hard at staying well. It's a constant effort not to get sick. And we end up paying for it. Healthy people are going to end up paying for those people who live unhealthy lifestyles, those who are constantly on stimulants. Okay? The ones who are trying to live a very pure, good life, who try to stay healthy, their premiums end up having to pay for these sick people. It's absolutely nuts. It's a Ponzi scheme. The whole world is absolutely nuts. Don't sugarcoat the world at all. And you get this whole, there's a whole class of entitlement people who own the media, who own all this propaganda, are able to do this. They keep what they're telling us. They don't tell us about spiritual freedom. They tell us that what they're really saying is, you know, you got to stay here and serve us. Serve our entitlements. Otherwise, you're guilty, you're bad, you're wicked. You never hear spiritual teaching through the media, through anything other than satsang. Never hear it. You're 100% entitled to free yourself from delusion and witness to the truth of your brother and sister in spirit. That's their truth. If they want to keep on this guilt trip, this egoic guilt trip, that's their problem. That's their delusion. They're imagining a fake person, a fake identity, and then telling us we have to serve that fake identity. No, we don't. They should have to suffer the consequences of that fakery. The great awakener is suffering. That's what I've been through my life, is non-stop suffering. I've done all the junk work. I've been a janitor cleaning up from all these brokers who are making all this money. All these guys who are wheeling and dealing and commodities and doing all this stuff that is clever manipulation. They leave a complete mess at the end of the day. Leave an absolute mess. Back in the day when everyone was chain smoking, clean up the ashtrays, clean up everything, clean up the junk. Janitors, who do you think's cleaning up all the offices every day? I've been there and done it. Patching the roads, pumping the gas, doing volunteer work, trying to help people, picking up garbage, picking up demo, stuff that's demolished, cleaning up demo work, taking to the dump. I've done all the junk work. So I know all the work that has to be done, all the cleanup work. Look at all the maids coming in, dusting all the homes, constantly cleaning homes. You think that's fun? They're hard workers. The working class work hard. And they can't keep up buying all this stuff. They have to work harder and harder and harder. I remember somebody, this well-meaning upper-class worker who volunteering to help children in India. And she said, she told all the children, these are the working-class, untouchable children who do all the sanitation work, all the dirty work nobody else wants to do. And yet somebody has to do it, right? Somebody has to do all the dirty, messy work to keep all this going. And she told him, you know what, your only problem is you're not getting educated. So we're providing free education for you, providing the funds to put you through school and put you through college. And she says, our goal in this world, and this should be the goal of everything, she said, this is the spiritual goal, the spiritual masters, everybody's working for this. Everybody gets a college education. So you never, ever you get a good job, and you never, ever have to do that horrible work now that you're slaving in, that makes you sick and everything. Oh, okay, so everybody gets an education, right? We all have a college degree. Nobody has to do the dirty work anymore. So who is going to do the dirty work then? We all have a college education. We're all entitled to a wonderful job. So who's going to do the dirty work then? Is it just going to disappear? Nobody's going to have to go to the bathroom anymore. There's no sanitation workers, and no garbage, no road repair work. Dust is going to stop falling. No maids. Nobody has to clean up the dust. No gardeners anymore. No repair people. No mechanics have to fix your car anymore. Nobody has to do oil change anymore, because we all have college degrees, so all those jobs disappear. And our cars, don't need to be fixed anymore. I mean, what kind of madness do these upper class, wealthy, altruistic, good people have, thinking that if they give everybody a college education, that they've solved the problems of the world? What insanity is that? I dropped out of college because I realized this is nuts. I said, what, I get a college education? Sure, I can get a good position, a professional position. That's not going to solve the problems of the world. I'll be entitled to this. I just saw it. I realized it's just pushing entitlement. You're developing an attitude, a complete mindset of entitlement that you then project onto others. And I said, I'm not willing to do that. Forget it. I I can't handle it. I try to do all the work myself. I do an oil change, I do it myself. Garden work, I do it myself. Something breaks, I fix it myself. I don't want to push it off on someone else. I know our whole economy works on pushing it off on someone else. So now I say, okay, I know, I understand. I go to the oil change, that, you know, that someone's having a job changing my oil. But the fact is, our entire economy is based on pushing everything off like that. More and more people, so many, too many people in the world. Everybody's got to eat. Everybody needs to work. We need to keep generating more and more work, more and more jobs. Can't last. It's a Ponzi scheme. House of cards. Everyone gets a college education. Problem solved, huh? I wonder how much thought went into that person's, you know, where did they learn that? Who's teaching them that? That's the upper classes. They think, hey, we got the answer to everybody. Does everybody get an education? Everybody get a college degree? Problem solved. The problems of the world are solved. No, they're not. They're even worse than before. Because we're all deluded 10 times more. And instead of spending our life getting enlightened, we spend it getting a college education and professional degrees. Master's degree, a PhD. We spend our time going to all these conferences. Just maintaining our entitlements. And we haven't spent any time focusing on freedom from existence. And so we haven't done any good at all. Because everything still remains the same here. And everyone is, the reason why people are battling each other is they're battling over entitlements. And now the poor people have learned about entitlements. And so there's a whole class of entitlement people who have learned how to game the system. And those people who don't believe in any entitlements for themselves or anyone else responsible for their own life, then they're going to end up working to support everybody. Support the rich and to support the poor. And there's too much burden then. Too much burden on them. As they say, there are people, I mean, I grew up where we're too proud to take any entitlements. We're not going to take food stamps. We're not going to take welfare. We're not going to take unemployment. We're not going to take anything. That's how I was brought up. That's how I was taught. You are not entitled to anything here except that what your own hard work can bring you. You're not even entitled to medical care. This idea that everybody's someone entitled to it. This, we have a madness of college-educated people on this planet who think that somehow because they're entitled to everything, that everybody should just be entitled to everything. As soon as you can get a college education, you're entitled to everything. You're entitled to free everything, free medical care, retirement, free pensions, you know, when you retire for the rest of your life. Food, you're all entitled to food, shelter, transportation, medical care, entertainment, travel, clothing. You're all entitled to all of this. Like magically, by saying you're entitled to it, somehow you're going to have it all. It's pie in the sky. Been sold a bill of goods. Somebody is producing all this and distributing all of it and trying to keep the whole thing going to these people who simply believe in entitlement. The healthcare thing is just madness, absolute madness. People, you know, they can't retire. I mean, my age, who's going to be able to retire? Only those who have gamed the system very well or pushed themselves through stimulants to grab a hold of enough money somehow. But even that is slipping through their fingers. Most people are now saying, well, they're going to have to work their entire lives. But by pushing yourself with stimulants your whole life, guess what? Your body breaks down. Guess what? You end up having tremendous medications now. People are living, being kept alive through medications right now. I tell you this. People are working so hard just to survive right now that the stress is so severe that their cholesterol, their blood pressure, their blood sugar, there's so many things wrong with their health, and what are they doing? They're keeping themselves going by very expensive medications. Can they retire? No, because they can't afford to pay for their medications. So literally, they're having to work themselves to death. They have to keep working just to pay for the medications because their lifestyle is so stressful that their health is falling apart. Eventually, they're going to end up in intensive care hospitals where, you know, the medical bills are how much per day? Like, I don't know, $10,000, $20,000, whatever. Incredibly expensive. And then it becomes necessary to terminate their lives quickly. You can't have, I mean, my grandmother stayed in a hospital. How much money did she spend? I mean, the people used to have really good insurance. I mean, they got sick. She had leukemia. She had to have transfusions, all stuff. Spent a fortune on medical bills, but it was all covered by insurance. She lived to be very old, you know. We're living longer and longer, so our health, we have longer and longer needs for medical care. And the cost of medical care now is so extreme. Can we afford an entire generation of people to go through like 10 to 15 years of constant expensive medical care before they die? The fact is that will be economically impossible. And the fact is that people are going, their lives are going to be terminated. Now, I happen to know the whole assisted living industry. I know the people who run it. And they've been honest with me. They've told, the fact is that patients there who can't afford to pay, their insurance runs out, or they're, even if they're really troublesome, you know what happens? They're over-medicated. They're over-medicated. Okay? There are ways, and what happens? They die. They're literally killed. That's a fact. There are ways to ease people out when the system can no longer support them, all elder people, they're killed. And it's all, you know, it's all tolerated. There are ways to do it. It's like, oh, sure, there are regulations that are supposed to look out after this, but it's all gotten around. And the way that things are going in this country with the health of people, I mean, my gosh, I was raised, and we were raised to say, you know, it's your responsibility to stay healthy your entire life. Okay? It's your responsibility. You have to learn to stay healthy. And I use my mind and my will to stay healthy. I refuse medical help. I have an attitude like a Christian Scientist. I'm responsible for my health. Nobody else is responsible for my health. If I get sick, it's my fault. Not somebody else's fault. It's not my genetics. It's not my environment. It's not anything except my responsibility. And for me, if I get sick, that's it. You know? Who can afford? It's crazy. We can't afford medical insurance, but when this whole thing of everybody getting medical insurance, most people are not going to be able to afford that either, the premiums. The whole thing is unsustainable. We have a population that is going to become so sick. But the obesity, the health of America, because we run on stimulants. We've run on gorging ourselves. We're trying to simulate multidimensionality. And we've caused ourselves to become so sick. I mean, my gosh, it used to be we lived in such an austere way. I was brought up to say, you have a few material possessions. You live an austere life. It's your responsibility to be healthy. Waits not, want not. You know, completely changed now. Everybody wants more and more junk, more and more junk, more and more junk. They're gorged, their lives are, their houses are overflowing with stuff. They're obese, they're fat. Their health is going to collapse. They're on so many medications that are very, I talk to doctors. Okay? Doctors tell me, look, I played golf with a doctor. I mean, playing golf with people, you talk with them and you get people from all walks of life, professional people, and they're honest with you. You know, they level with you. I talk with them, and they, doctors, I've played golf with doctors. And they tell me, my God, you will not believe what's going on in medicine. I say, well, tell me, I'm all ears. People talk to me because I listen to what they say. And I believe what they say. And they said, you will not believe how many young people are coming to me and having to be on heavy medication that in the past only old people needed it. He says, people in their 20s now need medication that used to be people in their 70s and 80s. And they say it's completely insane, out of control. These are doctors talking. People, young people now are on heavy medication. And it's just not antidepressants, anti-anxiety medications, all types of medications. They're on, I asked the doctor, what are these medications for? And they says systemic breakdowns. And I say, what is causing the problem? Why? He said, stress. He says, the world is killing these people. They're under too much stress. And their systems are breaking down. These are MDs I'm talking to. Okay? Who are in the front lines of this battle over health. And MDs are good people. Doctors are good people. Okay? They're trying to help people's health. And they're saying that it's collapsing. And medical care situation now is going to kill the doctors. It's dumping the whole situation in the doctor's laps and saying, you fix it, you deal with it. It's making all these idealistic entitlement, bureaucratic, high-class people who think they can make a perfect world, and it's not they're dumping all the work onto the laps of the doctors and says, here, it's your problem. We've fixed the problem. We're perfect. We're building a utopia here. It's going to kill the doctors. It's going to drive them out of business, or it's going to cause them to be overworked. It's impossible. Nobody is teaching individual responsibility. Austerity, individual responsibility, quality, and spiritual teaching. From day one, you should be receiving spiritual teaching as your number one goal. You shouldn't have a college education as your number one goal. It used to be college education was only for professionals who had a need to, like doctors. Doctors went to university because they needed the training. We had vocational training, okay? You have now everybody bankrupts their parents or bankrupts themselves through student loans to get a college degree because you're supposed to have that. You can't get a job without it, which is complete discrimination, by the way. I mean, if I go in and I want to get a job and they say, where's your college degree, and I'm not hired, that's discrimination. Total discrimination. And nobody says anything about that. If you don't have a college degree, you are completely discriminated against in this country and in the world. Okay? Absolute discrimination. Because who says that if I don't have a college degree, somehow I can't do the job just as well as somebody who has one? Nonsense. Probably do it better. Because I'm honest and conscientious, self-reliant. I'll show up every single day. I'll work hard. I care about it. I care about success. You know, a lot of stuff there. College degree people, they're thinking about how rich they can be. Their entitlements. They're thinking about paying off their college loans. They've learned entitlement. They've learned about pushing the hard work off onto somebody else. Okay? The whole system we have is, how do we push the hard work off onto somebody else? Because, well, I'm educated. I don't have to do that work anymore. So number one, you have to have a spiritual education for everybody. That's the goal, not college education. College education only for those who are absolutely necessity for it. Spiritual education will teach you that you what you really are. You're a multidimensional being. And this world is your attempt to separate from what you are, to forget what you are, so that you can be something different than what you are. You want to try to change what you are. You must be taught that what you are, you cannot change what you are. You cannot change what you are. You cannot modify what you are. It's impossible. All this is a waste of time. Existence is nothing but a waste of time. It's a senseless, meaningless, aimless wandering about. That's all it is. And the people in charge of this planet, these idealists, are insane. Totally insane. And they know it. And they're scared, and they say, well, I don't know, we need all these slaves to make us feel happy. to make us feel important. We need everybody to follow our rules, our regulations, to make us feel better about ourselves, make us feel better about our false identity. You know what? That's not our responsibility to do that. It's not our responsibility to prop up the insane and make them feel good about their insanity. It's our responsibility to assure them they can free themselves from this insanity. So it used to be that saints and sages and gurus and pundits were revered because they assured us we could free ourselves from this misery. Okay? Now that's gone with the wind. Now we're following these so-called enlightened bureaucrats who think they know how to make a utopia here on this planet, which is insanity. And fortunately for us, our shift into multidimensionality is now here. When people talk about the return of Christ, they're talking about the return into multidimensionality, which is our true identity, which is our true functionality. Identity is nothing without functionality, just like a cause is nothing without effects. So when we talk about our identity, we're talking about our functionality. How do we function? We function multidimensionally through interweaving this rich tapestry of experiencing in a seamless, flawless flow that is so beautiful, so delightful. We have no idea. Our imagination cannot imagine it. That is our identity. That is our home. We are home in multidimensionality. We're not home here in Flatland. We're not here to serve these insanely bureaucrats of their idealistic notions of creating a utopia on this planet. We're not here to serve that insanity. We're here to serve their freedom from that insanity. We're here to assure them that they have equal access to multidimensional functioning as we do. Everyone has equal access to unconditional love. That their true identity is untarnished, unharmed by dreams of its destruction. We're here to reassure them of that. That's why the planet has to be based on spiritual reassurance, which is why the teachers, the gurus, the pundits, the sages, the saints, and all from all traditions, those who have awakened to their multidimensionality, who are aware of this, they should be revered. Not worshipped, but revered. Different thing. Worshipping implies somehow someone else has greater access. That is not true. Revered because they're telling you the truth that you have equal access to multidimensionality right this moment. Unconditional love has equal access to everyone. We're all pre-qualified for that. So those who tell you that should be revered because they're telling you about your freedom. They're reminding you about your freedom. Freedom from this hell of this world. And fortunate are the ones who have found out how hellish this world is, who have been sick, who have suffered, who have done the menial labor to prop up the pretensions of others. Those are the blessed ones, because when multidimensionality, they remember and they say, wow, I'm in. I'm all in with this. Because I know staying in this world, I'm going to end up living in a garbage pile. Because I cannot trick my brothers and sisters. I don't want to trick them. I don't want to sell them junk. You know, these honest business people, I know one that he sells me this stuff and it breaks, and he feels terrible about it. He says, I'm sorry, you know, this is junk. I can't find good stuff to sell you. It's eating them up. It's killing them. You know, people used to be that way. I guarantee you. They looked you in the eye and they say, what I'm selling you, I stand by it, it's good. And they know it's good. And if something happened, they would be sad and they say, brother, I am truly appalled, you know, at that this broke, what I sold you broke. I'm going to give you a free one, replace it, you know. And I'm truly sorry for that. And they mean it. Because, you know, they had integrity and they had some spiritual teaching in their lives. You know, we have downgraded spiritual teaching to the point where it's become fluff. It's nothing but an empty carcass right now. It is window dressing. It is tinsel. It is superficial. We've lowered the bar of expectations. People pay lip service to it. They're so desperate to get an education, to get a college degree so they can even get a job. Because no, you know, good jobs, they won't have to be doing this horrible labor their whole lives. And getting these massive student loans, trying to pay off these loans, they're in a, drinking coffee, constantly ruining their health just to try and avoid, you know, a life of hellish labor that they can't spend even a minute on spiritual considerations. The only people who can, it seems like, is older people who somehow, you know, have retired or somehow are in a situation where they're not in the rat race anymore, and by that time their will is kind of feeble. It's the young people who have the energy and the capacity to break through illusion and delusion. Spiritual path requires a tremendous commitment, tremendous effort, intensity. In my situation, I felt so sick because I was so conscientious. I took all the stress of the world on me. I said, man, I got to fix everything here. Well, this is a horrible place. Look at these people are living in this hell. I got to fix it for them. How awful. You know, I got pulled into that because people rejected my teaching of multidimensionality, rejected the truth. And I felt so sorry for them. I said, okay, if you don't want that, what can I do for you? And they said, God, you know, fix all this stuff. Everything's breaking. It's terrible. So I felt I had to fix everything for everybody. And the stress of that was impossible and broke my health into pieces. So I couldn't even work. I was incapacitated by stress. I was fortunate. I was taken care of, minimally taken care of. I had a roof, you know, room and board. But I fell behind in the rat race. So I don't have any position now at all. No way to make money, no way, no resume, you know, just completely discriminated against. There's no resume. People say, where's your resume? You know, I can't hire you unless you, you know, have all this resume and degrees and all this stuff. Discrimination. So, but in that situation, I was able to use all my youth and young middle age and all of that. I still had intensity. I used it all on the spiritual path. Used it all up. Got almost nothing left. But I now see the truth. So I know for a fact that if you're going to take a spiritual path and be successful with it and break through the illusion, you need to start when you're young. Very difficult to start when you're old. The intensity isn't there because you have to work at it with intensity and determination. Because it's very difficult to see through the complete madness of existence, the insanity of it, and to get back to the simplicity of it. Because everybody is pulling at you with guilt. And everybody's going to tell you that you're responsible for their problems. If you want them to be happy, you have to fix their problems. And it's so difficult to be pulled in all these different directions. Takes all your energy. So when you're young, you've got enough energy to buffer yourself a little bit so you can still focus on the spiritual path. You know, you can almost do it all. And you need to, because the guilt will drain you of energy. And you have two ways to go. You can be the one who is pushing the guilt off on others, or if you're conscientious, then you'll have to accept the guilt to some extent. And that drains you of energy. But when you're young, you still have enough energy to focus on the spiritual path too. But you can't do it all. You cannot do it all. In other words, if you're pursuing a business and all these advanced degrees and trying to solve the problems of the world and all that stuff, you end up sacrificing what? The spiritual path. You end up sacrificing that, and you'll be uninformed of what's the most important thing to be informed about. Vital, absolute solution, how to get free of guilt, how to get free of delusion. You won't know. You'll still think you this is your home, this is where you're stuck. Your body is your identity, and you're responsible for all of this, and you'll still be entirely stuck in all this delusion, all this karma, and all this nonsense, all this fantasy, this pretense. and you'll be terrified to let it go. Because you think this is all that there is. You think that God is responsible for all this. Or the scientists say it all arose out of nothing. It's funny, the atheists say, well, all this arose out of nothing. It all comes from nothing. Something comes from nothing. And then they say, well, God is nothing. Nothing at all. Well, if everything arises out of nothing and God is nothing, then aren't they defeating their own argument? Because couldn't all of this then be arising out of God? It's a circular argument. It's a nothing argument. Everything arises out of nothing is a nothing argument. You know, they don't see it's completely circular. It's ridiculous. What's really true is not everything arises out of nothing, but all of this is nothing. It's very different. And nothing is just an idea that Spirit had. The idea of changing reality is a nothing idea. It's an idea of nothingness. It's a pretense. Nothing, all of existence is nothing dressed up in pretense. It's like a skeleton, a fashion show of skeletons. That's all it is. It's the idea of nothing. So scientists don't understand this at all. Physicists who have now discovered the God particle, etc. Some super advanced physicists maybe can understand what I'm saying. Maybe, or they think, well, maybe might be able to. At least maybe they have the pretension that they can kind of understand it, maybe. But not really. I mean, Krishnamurti, a lot of his devotees are very advanced and scientists and very intelligent people, intellectuals. Some top quantum physicists were some of his really devotees really paid attention to what he had to say. But they didn't really understand what he was saying. They thought they did. They said, well, I think my mind can probably grasp that because it can grasp this abstract physics. But the spiritual path is a little different than, they don't get it. They don't quite really get it at all. They don't get the fact that they can't get it. Okay? Existence is not understandable. You can't get it. And they don't get it that they can't get it. They don't realize that it's not getting it that's the answer. It's dropping it is the answer. Exchanging it is the answer. It's saying, this is worthless. I want to exchange nothing for everything. That's all you can do, is exchange nothing for everything. And what good is getting that? Getting it isn't the exchange. Like saying, I understand that. Okay, intellectually I understand that, so I've got it now. No, you got to make the exchange. And the spiritual path is all about making the exchange. Not about some hypothetical, plausible I, some other identity, understanding that this other identity isn't really an identity. That's not it. That is not it. So even the scientists, the top ones, don't have the right education. And so what? They discover a God particle. So what? Doesn't change your existence at all. Not really. Doesn't exchange the impermanence of everything of existence at all. It's a waste of time. Waste of time. Waste of resources. Complete waste of time. Everything in existence is a waste of time except intense inquiry, spiritual inquiry. Because that is the only thing we can do that will show us that all of existence is simply a waste of time. And we will be happy with that because we know that existence is a fraud. It is the idea of trying to change reality. Is what happens when we believe we can change reality. Existence arises. Now we drop this insanity that we can change reality, drop this idea, drop this desire. Back in multidimensionality, we say, perfect, everything's perfect again. I'm functioning in perfection again. It's just a dream, you know, I dropped the dream. But if we decide again that reality can be changed, boom, the dream will arise again for us. It's not like we can find a way to believe that we can change reality without having this horrible dream of existence arising. It's impossible. If we ever believe we can change reality, this dream of existence will once again arise. Always be the case that whenever we want to believe desire to change what we are, we will dream a dream of existence, of impermanence, of suffering, of misery. See, there's no way you can change that. No way you can get rid of it. Those who are saying we can make a utopia here are deluded. What they're saying is we can have our cake and eat it too. We can change our identity, change reality, change what we are, and still live in this, live in a utopia. Not true. 100% not true. So real spiritual teaching points this out. You cannot have your cake and eat it too. In other words, you know, we can't quote unquote fix the problem. We keep thinking the problem is that, yeah, we had this great idea of changing what we are, but it's really, we're suffering terrible. I mean, that's the problem. No. The problem is that we chose this idea in the first place, thinking that we could make it all right. Cannot. It's impossible. We can never realize this. We can't change reality. So we're just in a dream of delusional, dream of pretense. Constantly needing to forget reality, which is why existence is so crazy and impermanent. Because how do we forget permanence except through a dream of impermanence? Will the physicist who discovered the God particle tell you this? No. Are those physicists who worked on this CERN, you know, collider, who discovered the God particle, are they, when they give their press conferences, are they telling you this, what I'm telling you right now? And if not, why not? Because this is what's important. Our problem is we thought that we could change reality without having this terrible dream of impermanence. It's not true. In order to believe that we can change what we are, change reality, we have to forget reality. Because if we didn't, we would realize that reality isn't changed in the slightest bit. We'd be experiencing reality, and we'd know it's not changed at all. So how could we even believe it could be changed if the evidence is right there for us, it's not changed at all? So what we have to do is we have to try and forget reality. And what is reality? Reality is permanent. Permanence. The laws of reality don't change at all. So what will we do? We have to have a dream of impermanence. This dream of impermanence is required to hold on to the idea of being able to change reality and become prime creator. It's a requirement. We can't dispense with it. I don't care if we discover a God particle or not. We cannot dispense with the nature of this dream, the impermanent nature of this dream. It's impossible to dispense with that. So it's impossible to dispense with sickness and impermanence and suffering and misery in this dream. This dream has to be this way because we have to try and maintain this forgetfulness of what we are, of forgetfulness of reality. We have to conjure up this insane, crazy dream and keep this dream going just so we can look at this dream and be in a state of forgetfulness of what reality is. And we have to continue because reality doesn't change at all. So this dream is continuous. As long as we hold on to this idea of wanting to change what we are, we have to keep identifying with this crazy dream and keep dreaming it and keep suffering and keep all this madness going. There's no two ways about it. The only solution is to exchange this dream, to exchange the desire, to exchange the belief that we can change reality for the belief that we cannot change it. Exchange the desire to change reality to the desire to not change reality. Exchange the dream for a dream of truth that we cannot change reality. Exchange impermanence for a dream of permanence, and then eventually we don't need a premise at all, and then we will function multidimensionally, perfectly, flawlessly, knowing that reality, the laws of reality, are unchangeable. That's the only way. And so as you listen to these scientists, are they telling you this? Because if they're not telling you this, they're wasting your time, and you're wasting your time. If these idealistic bureaucrats who keep passing all these laws, are they telling you this? If they're not telling you this, they're wasting your time, and you're wasting your time with them. I tell you this, it's better for them to be street sweepers in Calcutta than it is for them to be up in their lofty positions of cabinet positions, etc., etc. Way better for them to be experiencing the drudgery and hell of this planet. Because then they'll start thinking, wait a minute, this place sucks, this is terrible. And then they'll start thinking, how do I get out of this place? And then they'll start listening to spiritual teaching. And then they'll start realizing, hey, there is a way to get free of this. It's not good to prop up these fat cats and these bureaucrats and these utopians and these idealists and these people who are selling us a bill of goods. It's not good to prop them up. It's better the whole thing collapses and they taste the bitterness of that dust, because then they'll start saying, hey, I want to get out of this. This is terrible. And then their spirit will say, hey, there's a way out. And they'll say, really? And they'll say, yeah. Tell me. I want to know. Believe me, when your suffering gets bad enough, you will want to know the way out. And if you don't have the medicines to kill the anxiety and the pain, you're going to pay attention to the way out. You're going to say, give me the way out. Right now, people just keep popping pills nonstop. Hold on 1 second here. I'll be right back. Okay. So, really, don't cry for what's to come upon the world. Because this world is not doing anyone any good right now, at all. We have so gutted the religious and spiritual traditions of the planet. I mean, I go to church. I mean, I evaluate all this stuff. And it is so gutted and diluted that it's not doing anyone any good. Spiritual teaching is intense. It is purposeful. It is important. You know, these gurus don't mess around. They, you know, I mean, just think, if you're trying to have a profession as like a top architect or some top professional, I mean, some of these things are cutthroat. That they don't mess around. I mean, you are there. I used to live with this young man who, this family in Japan, and these people were at the top university, Tokyo University. They were going for PhDs in engineering, okay, the top fields, and they didn't mess around. I am telling you, they spent every second of their lives in full-on, intense, focused, purposeful study and intensity. Just imagine, that is the intensity you need for the spiritual path. There are countless people fighting like crazy to get in the top universities in the world. And knowing if they get a degree from that university, they're going to be set for life. Okay? They don't mess around. They're studying every minute of the day. Imagine if the planet, if all those people on the planet were taking the spiritual path under gurus, with satsang, with spiritual teachers who really know what they're talking about. Imagine if all of them were putting all of that intensity and focus on that. What would happen to this planet? We would be, the people would be reassured there's a way out. So we have completely messed up our values here. We don't need more engineers, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, etc., 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 architects. We don't need it at all. Because they're just continually, actually, what they're teaching them now is how to build stuff cheaper and fake it better and better and better. What we need is sages and saints and gurus. What we need, we don't need universities, we need ashrams and theological seminaries. We need monasteries and nunneries and all these places, but where they go for spiritual teaching. I mean, men and women should have the right to a vocation of spiritual teachers. That should be number one vocation on the planet. The reverence should be there as it used to be. The livelihood should be the top livelihood, to go into theological vocation, a vocation of clarification of truth. And then those people spend their lives reassuring others. I mean, the spiritual traditions of this planet were very noble. I mean, these days priests are just getting absolutely savaged, okay, and for reasons, some of which are valid. But the vast majority of priests are very good people. And they're dedicating their lives to trying to remind us about salvation. And this is in all spiritual traditions. In Buddhism, and all the, you know, Hinduism, Islam, all the traditions, you name it. There's a lot of people trying to remind us of salvation, but people are not even paying attention anymore. I mean, I hear the priest talking, very good priest, I know. Very wise, very smart. And they keep trying to slip in truth to their homilies, etc. I'm looking, people are completely tuned out. Nobody is getting it at all. He's wasting his time. People are so distracted. They can't relate it to their lives. And a priest left recently, and they can't be replaced. And we were told, well, sorry to say that there is nobody taking a vocation this year for this diocese. You know, no vocations at all. None. Zero. In Ireland, it used to be that, you know, that being a priest was the number one thing to do in a family. It was the highest honored, esteemed profession to go into the priesthood. And every family would send their, you know, at least one into the priesthood, into a religious vocation. Right now, I think Ireland, they say last year they didn't have any priests, maybe one or two, who chose that as a vocation. It's completely disappeared. And now it's just that way out of poverty. You know, back then, of course, it was way out of poverty too, but it was still revered and important. Now people will say they can get money some other way. Forget it, you know. But the whole idea of religious vocation is for people to remind us about our salvation. That there is a way to be saved from existence. That's what it's all about. And we need it. Because this world is a place of forgetfulness. We need every community in America like has churches all over the place, right? And the idea is you're supposed to go to church not only on Saturday night, whenever, once a week, but you should be able to go to church any day, afternoon, after work, etc. Whenever you feel you're becoming forgetful of salvation, you should be able to go there. There should be counselor, spiritual counselor there who reminds you of salvation, of truth. How can you be freed from this delusion, this delusional dream of existence? And it's necessary to have that spiritual network of reassurance. It's necessary to have that because this world is a place of extreme forgetfulness of what we are. Near total forgetfulness. I mean, we are immersed in forgetfulness of what we are. So you need a system, a vast network of those who remind us and reassure us. Without that, the planet will absolutely fall into extreme wickedness, which it has done. We're already there. This network is broken down. I used to be, there was a Christian Science reading room in every town in America. And you could go there any time of the day and drop in and read the literature and talk with maybe a Christian Science practitioner. Christian Science is actually based on truth. Okay? But now that is complete, that has fallen away so severely. My gosh, now Christian Science places are actually become radicalized, like taken over by idealists, radical idealists, utopianists. Okay. I go in there and the people are preaching radical feminism to me in a Christian Science reading room. I say, what are you talking about? That's not what this teaching is about. It's not about empowering us on this planet. It's about freeing us from delusion that we're physical flesh beings, that this planet is real, this material world is real. It's realizing that we can let go of all sickness, that sickness is an illusion, that poverty, that scarcity is an illusion, that we are wrapping ourselves up in and trying to forget what we really are. So, you know, I don't feel like I can go into any place, any town in this country or world and get right guidance, right remembrance, right advice, anywhere. I can't go to a Catholic church and get, I can't go into a Protestant church. I can't go into a Christian Scientist place. I don't know anywhere where I can go where I can be reminded of truth, other than in some top satsang like Muji or someone like that, who I feel has done a lot of good work. I don't know how to rate it ultimately, but at least he's hitting a lot of right notes. Okay, but very limited opportunity. He opens a satsang, it's sold out immediately. Okay, where's the opportunity? I don't have money to travel there anyway, it's impossible. I want to be able to go down the street in my town to a place and ask some questions of a spiritual practitioner who can reassure me of truth. It used to be able to do that. It's gone with the wind. And now on YouTube, why have this channel? So people can come here and be reassured of truth. But, you know, very, very few are doing that. By the view count is obvious. You look at all the videos that have all the views, it's so silly. It's based on how to forget truth. Those that get the millions and millions of views. But it's terrifying. This planet is absolutely terrifying because there's nowhere you can go to hear truth anymore. You go to a place now and they propagandize you with some utopian nonsense about equality and social justice and how to build, you know, nonsense. That's not the gospel of Christ. Social justice gospel is not the gospel of Christ at all. Gospel of Christ is multidimensionality, that we're spirit and truth, and this place is hell. And we need to be born again, meaning we need to be born back into multidimensionality. Okay? I once went to an antique shop. There was a Baptist guy there, old school. And I had a religious talk with him. How many people can walk and have a religious talk with anybody anymore? But I trusted him because he's old school. And he told me, he says, you know what we believe? You have to be born again. If you're not born again, you cannot be saved. He said, I absolutely believe that. And you know what? He's right. That is true teaching. The context has gotten messed up a little bit, but the fact is you must be born again of spirit, meaning of multidimensionality, because that is how spirit functions. And if you're not born again, if you are not awakened to multidimensionality, you will continue to dwell in hell, in the feeling of sin and guilt and destitution. That is a fact. And only this old school guy, you know, who didn't care about what anybody thought about him, will say such a thing like that to your face, you know. People who say that now are being marginalized like they're crazy. You know, they're not crazy. They're telling you the truth. It's just that they are only telling you because it's a dogma to them. They don't really understand what they're telling you. And I think that's what people are objecting to, and they're criticizing it. Atheists and scientists saying, you know, it's a waste of time. What are you talking about? Because they cannot clearly explain it, because they've been raised simply on dogma. Now, it's true dogma, but it's flat dogma. They don't have the depth of understanding. So then someone tells you, yeah, you got to be born again of Jesus, or you're going to be damned, and blah, 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 blah. Well, what it means is you must be born, you must awaken to your multidimensional functioning, which is what your identity is created to function as, spirit. Or else you are going to remain in this delusional drama of forgetfulness of what you are, and this delusional drama of forgetfulness is going to suffer severe catastrophe and problems. That's true. The sun is going to go into a red giant phase, and it is going to melt this earth down. That is a fact. That's in the Bible, is actually true. But the way that some people have presented it is they lack the context and clarity of it, you know, become very rigid and dogmatic and flat. And so that turns a lot of people off. But it's not wrong what is said. It's in the Bible very clearly what's going to happen. It's accurate. And in saying you must be born again. If you're not born again, you cannot be saved. That's what Jesus said. And people said, what are you talking about? What do you mean? I can't enter my mother's womb and be born again. And Jesus said, oh my gosh, you know, you people are really in a state of extreme forgetfulness. You don't understand what I'm talking about. You don't have the context. It's effort to acquire the context. That's why religious vocations are so important. Theological vocations are so important. Satsang, religious teaching, is so important from day one on this planet, from cradle to grave. Because you must develop the context, and you must realize what's being said. What's being said is you must be born again means you must have a rebirth into a new life. And that new life is the multidimensional life, the life of multidimensionality. Because that's what you were created to function as. Okay, that is a new birth. It is like being born again. And St. Paul said, it is not I that live anymore, it's Christ that lives within me. It means it is not this flat, flesh-based identity living in this dream of forgetfulness that is my life anymore. It is now this multidimensionality that I'm experiencing, that is living within me, this unconditional love. I'm completely qualified for this. It can never be taken away from me. That's what love means, is that you're completely supported. It can never be taken away from you. You feel, this is mine forever. I'm not harmed. I can't be harmed. That's love. Love is there forever for you. This is there forever. Multidimensionality is there forever for you. And St. Paul is saying, oh my gosh, I'm entitled to this. I'm pre-qualified. I'm pre-entitled. I don't have to do anything to earn this. It's all grace. When Martin Luther said, I am saved by grace, not by works, but by grace, that is a fact. We are saved by grace because we're pre-qualified for unconditional love, for multidimensionality. We don't have to do anything. We don't have to earn it. We don't have to tithe for it. We don't have to have these, what were they calling? The word escapes me at the moment. Indulgences, okay? We had to pay the Catholic Church indulgences. Everyone was buying indulgences thinking they could buy their way to heaven. That's nonsense. They thought they had to do all these works here on the planet to turn this world into utopia to be saved. Nonsense. We're saved by grace and grace only, meaning we're pre-qualified. Unconditional love puts no requirements on us whatsoever, zero. And all we have to do is awaken and accept and allow our awareness to be aware of multidimensionality. And there it is for us. That's the new life. That's the life we were created to have. It's always been there for us. So Martin Luther was right, but again, the context was not understood. He had an epiphany. Okay. He had an epiphany. And even he may not later on kind of struggle with the context of it. But he awoke to multidimensionality. He said, oh my gosh, this is free. It's here right now. Indulgences, you can't buy this. It's free. It's always available to us. You don't buy your way free of sin through indulgences to fatten the coffers of the cardinals. Okay? Multidimensionality is present, equally present, endlessly present for everyone, all times, all places, all situations, all circumstances. Everyone has equal access to it right now. Completely free, costs nothing. It's your inheritance, your birthright. It's your what you're entitled to. You're entitled to awaken to multidimensionality, even if you can't say it. You're entitled to it right now. In every moment, every single moment, even as the world collapses around you, you're entitled to it, to awaken to multidimensionality, and you will realize that everything is yours eternally. You can never lose anything. Nothing can ever be taken away from you. You can never be harmed. You can never be sick. You can never die. You're entitled to live in that. Not to understand it, not to get it intellectually, not the impermanent I to realize this. No, you are entitled to live it. You're entitled to dwell under God's rules and God's laws only. Not the laws of the ego, not the laws we've made up. All these laws of nature, we've made them up. We've imagined them. They're not God's laws. The laws that these physicists are looking at, they're not God's laws. Laws of nature are not God's laws at all. They're laws that we've made up to try and forget what we are. That is a fact. Fact. Fact, 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 fact. That's what we need to deal in facts. Or else we're dealing in nothing. And we need to get used to dealing in facts. instead of nothing. Because dealing in facts brings us back to awakening the multidimensionality, and that awakening, the opportunity is here now. It's always here now, but the pressure is on us now. Okay, because forgetfulness is about to take a dive, a nosedive. Because it needs to be ratcheted up, because we're starting to remember here, right? So many of us are starting to awaken to multidimensionality. And the ego says, oh, no, not so fast. We're going to take this whole thing down into a lower vibration. We're going to dive this whole thing down. We're going to fry. Everybody's going to fry. We're going to have this massive planetary sacrifice where everyone gets fried. So we can look at all this death and dying and say, ah, boy, this is what's real. Impermanence, look at the death and identity destroyed, everything. And that's how we keep our forgetfulness of reality, right? So the ego is going to hit us with a massive defense system to try to turn us away from multidimensionality. So what's happening? Prior to this planetary sacrifice that the ego has set up and is all in place and it's going to happen, prior to that, God's grace really starts chirping real strong, saying, hey, pay attention to this. Here's this on a silver platter, you know. Awaken. Multidimensionality is always there, but the Holy Spirit, God's grace, has a way to remind us of this very strongly, and it's going to use that reminder very strongly. It's like a breeze of awakening is going to come, and we'll suddenly be aware of multidimensionality. Say, oh wow, we're waking up to it. We're going to get a big boost. Prior to the planetary sacrifice, we're going to get a big boost. When the planetary sacrifice hits this planet, everything gets burned by fire. There's also going to be a frequency split. Some will split into a higher frequency, some will split into a lower frequency. The planetary frequency will split, so there'll be like three worlds. One will be destroyed by fire, another one will go into a very primitive situation with elite enclaves and a very slave labor kind of place, horrible place. Another will go into a science, tech, spirituality, fourth dimensional vibration, which will go on pretending that this is something really great, and there may be some developments in that that will develop into multidimensionality. People will awaken, possibly. I don't know if that's true or not. And then, but we don't need to do any of that. We don't need to go into a higher vibration, a lower vibration, or get burned by fire. We can shift into multidimensionality. When we realize multidimensionality, we realize we're free. We are free. We are literally completely free. You can literally shift into a light body if you want to at that point. If you've accepted and allowed multidimensionality, you are really free. You're free to go anywhere, do anything. You cannot be harmed at all. So that it will happen prior to all this splitting of the frequencies, burning of the melting of this earth by fire, all those things. We will awaken to multidimensionality. And the means to do that are coming. The means are always available to us. And yet we've been rejecting it. But now we've been calling these means to us. Help us out. We've been calling for a big boost. And we will receive that big boost. We will receive it, maybe in a way we don't know, because if we knew, the ego would block us, would turn us away from it. That's why I cannot tell you exactly how it's going to happen, because I don't even know. Because if I knew and I told you, the ego would go to work distracting you away from it, demonizing it, marginalizing it, putting a wedge of fear between you and it. That's why we're not really sure how it's going to happen. But it's arriving ahead of the galactic superwave, which is going to cause the frequency split and the melting of this world by fire. It's arriving ahead of that, about 6 months ahead of time. So it's already arriving here, which is why this teaching is very intense now. You've probably never heard a kind of teaching like this that is so intense. Just boom, 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 like right, you know, wow. I'm not sugarcoating it. I'm not saying you have all the time in the world, you know. I'm not laughing. I'm not, yeah, it's all great. It's not, yeah. No, it's right now. It's in our face. The situation is in our face. We wake up every morning and we realize we can't sustain all this. The stress will kill us trying to fix everything. Try to keep everybody happy here. It's going to kill us. Those people who are conscientious and honest and truly want eternal life for everyone. It's going to kill us. The stress is going to kill us. We can't keep it up. It's over. It's finished. Our projects are finished. All right? Drop it. We need to shift into awaken to multidimensionality. We need to awaken, and the means need to be given to us, and we need our attention to be there, and we need to demand it. Say, we are entitled to the big boost to awaken to multidimensionality. We are entitled to that right now. We call in all the sages and saints and gurus and avatars and you name it, saviors. We call all of that grace into this world, into our awareness right now. All of it that's ever been or ever will be, we call it into us. For us right now, we're entitled to it. We are entitled to be boosted into awareness of multidimensionality. We're absolutely entitled to it. Anybody who says they're on or not, I spit on them. Really. We should spit on them if they're not telling us that. Don't waste another second of your time if they're not saying, we are entitled to this, because we truly are. Because we were created by God. We are spirit. We're entitled to awaken to what we are. Anyone who doesn't emphasize this is wasting our time, and we don't have time to waste anymore. So this should be like a Martin Luther moment, you know? Free ourselves from wasting our time. Free ourselves from this lukewarm entitlement. No, we are 100% entitled to receive all of God's grace right now, to give us that big boost and awaken us to our multidimensional truth, our functioning in multidimensionality, so we can accept it. So we can say, yeah, I accept it. Get familiar with it and say, here we go. I can function this way. All right? We have to get used to it so we can say, I can function this way, and then we will truly be safe from whatever. Because the systems of this world are going to collapse. It's unsustainable. You just have these crazy utopian idealists trying to sustain it. It cannot be sustained. Our health is breaking down. Their efforts to sustain this utopia is breaking the back of the world. Of those people, the middle class, those people who are conscientious and truly want to be honest and fair and righteous and do the right thing and help everybody and make everything good, breaking their backs. You know, so eventually a camel, their back gets broken, you pile enough stuff on them. We're entitled, everybody's entitled to be free of that, to be born again. We're all entitled to the rebirth, the spiritual rebirth, absolutely. And we have to insist upon it. We have to assert it. We have to demand it. We are within our rights 100% to demand it, that this grace show up and give us this big boost and awaken us to multidimensional functioning. So that we can function this way. But this is how we were created to function. It's God's will that we function the way we were created to function. God's will is 100% there. It's only our will that is trying to forget, but we are not God's will. So we can call on God's will, which is calling on, when we call on God's will, we're calling on the grace of God. We're calling on the grace of God to awaken us to multidimensionality right now. And that all of the grace, the entirety of it, be given to us right now. We insist upon it. We're entitled to it. We're 100% entitled to it. We're all pre-qualified. Don't think there's somebody on this planet that's not pre-qualified. They absolutely are pre-qualified. Everyone. Not a single exception. Never will be a single exception to that. If they don't call on this grace, that's because they want to continue on with the pretense of trying to be prime creator, creating a separate reality. They want to see if they can accomplish that. Well, that's their choice. We don't have to support that choice. We don't have to support their pretensions. Their pretensions will support themselves. They will continue on whether we support it or not. They'll just think that we're crazy, that we've somehow been destroyed. They think that those who shift into multidimensionality have been destroyed, have disappeared, they're gone, they've been wiped out. That's their pretense. But they have to believe that just to keep pretending, forgetting what they are. They have to believe, oh, those who have shifted to multidimensionality, they've been annihilated. That's their fantasy, so that they can keep forgetting the truth, so they can keep pretending on the Patatha, pretending that they're prime creators. They've created a separate reality, a new reality. It's better. They will do that. They will just dismiss it. That's okay. We don't have to support their insanity. We don't have to boost it up. We don't have to try and make them feel comfortable in their insanity. That's their responsibility. That's the ego's responsibility. Let the ego take care of those who have chosen the ego. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Let the ego take care of those who choose the ego. We don't have to take care of that. It's not our job. It's the ego's job. And the ego tells us we must serve the ego. No, we don't. We can choose to serve our own reality, the reality that we are created to serve, which is functioning in multidimensionality, which is functioning in freedom, which is serving the will of God, that we be free. That is what we're entitled to serve. The ego has no authority over us. Only if we want to forget what we are does the ego have any authority over us. The ego's sole purpose is to forget what we are. If we give up the desire to forget what we are, we're under no authority of the ego whatsoever. None. So the ego can't boss us around anymore. Can't tell us that we have to try to prop up its insane plans of forgetfulness. No, the ego's very capable of maintaining forgetfulness without our help at all. Okay? Those people who want to continue to pretend, they don't need our help. The ego is 100% capable of doing its job flawlessly for them. The only problem is it doesn't work. And the ego's telling us we have to somehow make it work. It cannot work. So the ego's asking us to do the impossible. And we are within our rights to reject the request to accomplish the impossible. Okay, without any guilt. See, the ego wants us to attain perfect forgetfulness. So that the frailty of the ego is never recognized. The frailty of this idea of forgetting what we are is never recognized. That's impossible. The frailty is always inherently there, will always be there. So when the ego asks us to do the impossible, we're within our rights. We're entitled to say no. No, 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 no. Because it's really asking us to do nothing. And we cannot do nothing. Okay, we were not created to do nothing. We either have to dream of forgetfulness or function the way we created. We cannot do nothing. And trying to make the dream of forgetfulness permanent and completely stable and not fragile is impossible. So we're being asked to do nothing. We cannot do it. So we must reject the ego's request there and say no, no to it. We must be born again. You see, Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. Meaning, you know, I'm not going to play your games of, I know what your game is. You want me to try and accomplish the impossible for you. And Jesus said, no, 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 no. You can keep the dream of forgetfulness going as long as we desire to try and change what we are. You'll do that flawlessly. But you cannot remove the vulnerability of this forgetfulness to remembrance. You cannot ever remove that. It's impossible. Because in order to do that, you'd have to destroy reality. It's impossible. So, you're asking a completely insane, impossible request, a nothing request. It's not even, therefore, it's not a request at all. See, it's not a request. A request implies that what is being requested is possible. When you ask someone to do the impossible, it's not a request. It's not even a demand. It's nothing. It's really nothing. So the ego is really saying nothing at all. Since it's saying nothing at all, how can we respond to it? We really cannot. We cannot respond to it. So we're entitled to live. The only way we can respond to what the ego's saying is to be in a complete state of death. We cannot do that. I've tried. You end up feeling a state of complete chaos. Okay. I tried to please the ego. And what you feel is a state of complete chaos. And you have to jump back from that. It's impossible. To please the ego, it's impossible. Because you cannot maintain this state of complete chaos. So, the only other, what you can do is simply choose a different idea, choose to awaken to multidimensionality, and you don't need the ego there. So, you're not displeasing the ego there. The ego is only displeased by those who want to make forgetfulness permanent so they can pretend to be prime creators. then the ego's always displeased because they, you know, whenever the ego says, "Ah, you haven't made it permanent yet." still vulnerable. The ego says wants to get rid of all assurance of reality because the ego thinks if it gets rid of that, then forgetfulness will be permanent. Not true. That's a lie. That is a lie. That's what got me when I came into this world. The ego says, "Ah, you're ruining everything here because I've almost got forgetfulness permanent. So if you just shut up, we'll make it permanent and then everybody will be happy." You know, it's very difficult to fight against this insanity. As if the truth is not told here, somehow the truth will then disappear and not be true anymore. That is not true. It simply isn't true. It's a lie. So it's a futile thing. The ego keeps saying, if we just, no one speaks truth here, somehow we'll, that forgetfulness of truth will become permanent. Because they'll say, ah, it's gone. We've succeeded. Not true. All that happens is delay is extended. So we must speak truth here and reject the ego's complaints and bitter hostility toward that, saying somehow we're being wicked and hurting everybody. No, we're doing the right thing. We're minimizing delay. All of existence is just delay. The ego's game is just a delay game. That's all it is. So we are completely within our rights to speak up about truth and reassure everyone about truth, because that's all they have. Eventually they must return to it. All they're doing right now is delaying that return. And the ego is mischaracterizing the situation, of course, because that helps forgetfulness. Mischaracterizing it helps forgetfulness, which is the ego's purpose. The ego's a born liar, a born deceiver. Okay? That's all it is. So of course it's going to advocate for deception and complain and mischaracterize and say, "Oh, you people are telling truth. You're harming everybody because you're diminishing their forgetfulness. And what we need to do, we're almost 100% forgetful now. If we just reach 100%, then everybody will be happy and blah, blah, blah." It's a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie. Call the ego's bluff. So we're entitled to the grace to call the ego's bluff and to awaken the multidimensionality. We're entitled to it. And we need the big boost because right now the ego's voice is so strong on this world. So many people have bought into the lie that if we all just don't speak truth at all, don't reassure anyone about multidimensionality and truth and escaping, waking from the dream, if we just don't do that, if we're all very polite and tolerant of delusion, then we'll all become perfectly forgetful and truth will sort of vanish and it's gone. Nobody can see it. It's gone. And we can all say, ah, we can all agree together. We can all hold hands and sing together that truth is gone forever. And then, magically, like a phoenix, out of this, we'll suddenly feel perfect stability and invulnerability, and we will feel a new creation, oh, blah, blah, blah. That's what the ego is teaching everyone. That's what the ego is teaching everyone. And if you're not listening to some teachers very adamant about this, you're quasi going along with the ego's plan. Ego's plan is very severe. And if it's not pointed out directly, you are running the danger of actually being sucked into that plan. The ego is allowing a certain amount of soft spiritual teaching to wean us away from it. So we think we have spiritual teaching in this planet, but I'm telling you, it's very soft. It's a weaning process to wean you away from the adamant, clear, direct teaching and admonition and witnessing the truth, because you don't want to let go of that yet. You're unsure. You don't really trust the ego. So the ego gives you the soft teaching, and then gradually the true adamant teachings that you really need, you say, "Oh, that's too strong. I don't like that." And then the ego will give you even softer teaching and even softer teaching. And before too long, even the tiniest bit of teaching, you say, "Oh, that's too harsh, it's too strong, that's crazy to be that strong." And then the ego has you. And then the ego say, "Ah, you know what? If we just let go of this teaching altogether, that should work, shouldn't it? Because we won't find truth, see truth anywhere." And we say, "It's gone. We've destroyed it. It's completely, we forgot it so badly that truth disintegrated. And now we can have our own separate kingdom, and we're prime creators of this kingdom, and we not be bothered about the rules and laws of functioning of reality, because reality's disappeared through just complete neglect and disinterest." That's the big lie. That's the big lie. All it means is that we have gone into a severe state of forgetfulness, and we're denying, a severe state of denial. Reality is still there 100%. We haven't accomplished anything. We've simply wasted our time. That is the truth. So beware of soft teaching. Now, some will say that we've softened the teaching down so much that in order to go back to adamant teaching, we need to still use soft teaching because people reject adamant teaching. That is true up to a point. But there has to be rapid progress towards adamant, direct, intense teaching. Otherwise, the softness gets into you and you're totally vulnerable to even softer teaching. So that is a very slippery slope, which is why I say spiritual path has to be all out and intense, because you cannot dwell in soft teaching for very long. You have to make rapid progress. My teachers have always emphasized that to me. He says, go, 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 go. Faster, 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 faster. Come on. Don't. And I said, why? This teaching you've given me is great. What's the hurry? They say, no. This is soft teaching we've given you. You cannot dwell in soft teaching. You have to get to much clearer, more intense teaching fast. Because if you dwell in soft teaching, you're going to be pulled down. So even in the Course of Miracles, which is pretty intense teaching, it's still soft. And the teacher, the origin of that course, was, they say, is Jesus. I met with him many times, and he would say, faster, come on, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. You need to finish this course. Come on, come on, come on. I say, wow, you know, what's the hurry? It's great stuff. No, come on. It's soft. I said, what do you mean? You gave it out. How could it be soft? He says, because you were so used to very, very soft teaching that if I gave you the straight, you know, undiluted stuff, you would say, whoa, that's too strong. I can't handle that. Forget it and scare you. So it had to be softened up. But he said, you're not meant to stay within the softness. You have to get to stronger stuff. Okay, so, you know, the discussion groups I see in the Course in Miracles and all that stuff, it's so soft, it's so slow. They're not getting to, you know, the momentum. They kind of say, oh, let's just for the rest of our lives, let's just kind of read this stuff and consider it, and it's kind of nice, I feel nice, and, you know, let's, it's got to be intenser than that. It leaves you wide open to softening up more and softening more, because the ego will soften you up more. If you don't make rapid progress, the ego is going to turn you around and you will end up wasting your time and delaying. That is a fact. Spiritual teaching has to be intense, has to push through to being born again, or else it's failed and you will fall back down. So you have to find teachings and teachers that are more and more intense. You know, I found teachers who were more intense. I actually became my own teacher because I couldn't find the intensity in the planet. I found an Anandamaya Ma, very intense teacher. But I became my own teacher and was super intense and strict with myself and pushing myself relentlessly because I said, teachers in this world are too soft, pretty much so. There's a tradition of intense teaching like in Zen and things like that. But that problem with that is the intensity has become an end in itself. You have to have wise intensity, very wise intensity. Now, if you have a really good Zen guru, then they can do the job. But you can't just create an institutional system that's going to work for you of intensity. You need to have those who are living in multidimensionality, functioning in that perfect clarity, who know how to apply the intensity in the right way. You can't have an assembly line. It doesn't work. Because I've seen so much in the intense traditions, like Buddhism, very intense tradition in a lot of ways. And I've seen so many live their lives in that, and that doesn't work for them. They don't awaken. Because they're taking intensity as an end in itself. And has to be grace-guided intensity. You have to have flexibility. You have to know how to use expedience. And my mom would say, you must every day come up with expedience to maintain your intensity in a grace-filled way. And you have to be a genius in using expedience every day. It cannot just be a robotic-like intensity, because the ego is undermining everything constantly. And it's softening you up in ways you don't even realize. And so you have to keep shifting and changing tactics and using expedience. It cannot just be a mindless thing. Yeah, I'm chanting this, you know, 100,000 times a day. That becomes mindless at some point. And the ego, you know, will still have a hold of you. And you'll still be forgetfulness. You won't awaken. That's why, you know, living gurus are so important. You cannot institutionalize the whole situation. You have to have living gurus. So important. Or you have to be your own guru. One of the two. You know, I couldn't find a living guru. I had to become my own guru. Because the whole guru system is broken down. You know, it used to be, you know, there was a place that you would, as a young child, would go and you'd dedicate your entire life, and there would be living gurus there, awakened, multidimensional beings. And they would, you know, direct your life and say, do this, this, and this, and this, and that. And they would sculpt your life and get you so that you, your efforts were appropriate, and you would smash delay and you would awaken to multidimensionality. Very intense. That's broken down. That's been broken down. So a lot of us have to be our own gurus now. It's very difficult. It's not impossible. I've been my own guru. Having to somehow function that way, having to tune into intuition like I do in these videos. I simply talk from an intuitive level, not the personality level. And you know, speak as like a guru, except I'm being my own guru to myself, you know. I'm still guruing myself, which is necessary. I don't entirely trust the whole system the way it's broken down. I don't entirely trust the teachers of today, to tell you the truth. I don't trust that they're perfectly multidimensional with complete clarity and context on it. So they know exactly where you're at, exactly what to say. Ananda Maima knew exactly what to say to every single person that came to her. She knew exactly that where they were at, exactly what they needed to do. She gave them exact directions, saying, this is exactly what you need to do, because this is going to be the way that you, where you're at right now. She says every single person that came to her was at a different place on the path, needed different instructions. So she gave out personal instructions, private instructions. Says, this is instructions for you. Don't share with anyone else because they need different instructions. So she literally could see everyone's path and the best way to for each one to minimize their delay, and would give them instructions on that for them only. That was personalized instruction. That's what the real guru does. Personalized instructions. It's not just institutionalized. It's not even everybody coming to satsang, necessarily. That's part of it. But everybody has to be dealt with where they're at. And only someone who's perfectly awakened can do that. Otherwise, we almost have to guru ourselves. Course in Miracles is self-study. I guess Jesus recognized that this, you know, the whole guru system is broken down and can't rely on it anymore. And the teachers that we have, I've looked at so many teachers and I said, wow, you know, they don't have it. And I don't blame them. I blame the whole system. It's systemic. The breakdown has been systemic. So it's just very difficult for anyone now to function on that level of individual guidance for everyone that comes to them, saying just the right thing, doing just the right thing, giving just the right grace, dealing with everybody just the right way. Yeah, that's the touch of the guru, you know, the awakened ones. the ones who are functioning perfectly in multidimensionality, and for them, it's they can do it. They can do it. But one has to be functioning in multidimensionality perfectly with, you know, with completely comfortable doing that and not ever being tempted to drop that based on the ego's demands of this world, thinking that the ego has some better way to help here. Let's institutionalize it, the ego says. We could be more successful if we just find an assembly line, It's not possible. It's not possible. You cannot have an assembly line to truth, to awakening. It's not possible, because the ego has, everyone has a vast array of defenses all intertwined, and the ego's constantly playing with these defenses. And whatever assembly line you get on, the ego will just easily soften it up for you. So, it's not possible. You literally have to reestablish the guru system. Or, you literally have to be your own guru. That, you know, that requires enormous effort and help and boosts, and you have to get a big boost as well. We have to get boosts. Otherwise, the play of the ego is too clever for us. And so we have let our guard down, thinking that all this industrial revolution and science, technology, and advance in materiality, etc., is going to make the path easier for us, and we could, you know, give up our intensity. That somehow there'd be a way to, you know, there's some app on a smartphone that's going to do it for us. We were deluded. We were tricked. We were deceived. Okay, it's like the merchants from Europe coming over to Long Island and giving the Indians some glass beads from Venice. You know, giving a chest of glass beads. It cost them, you know, trifle, and saying, here, we'll give you these beads if you give us Long Island. You know, the Indians are, wow, you know, when this land, we got a lot of land, but we've never seen these beads before, you know. Coming with all these trinkets, these smartphones and all this stuff, it seduced everyone into laziness. We let our guard down, and the whole system has systematically collapsed based on the whole industrial revolution and how it's developed. See, I got this microphone. I have this laptop. I have this, it's wireless. I have my mouse. I have this software. I have YouTube. I have the internet, you know, everything. I have all this stuff. I'm using it. But I'm also completely intensely focused on remembering what I am, my multidimensionality. And I'm putting all my effort into this right here, you see? So I didn't let down my effort just because of all this technology came in. I had to work harder. It became much more difficult because I had to try and deal with all this stuff, because the ego's saying, well, you got to help everybody, you know? Well, to some extent, you know, I'm trying to share this truth with you, and that's my responsibility. But I had to keep self-guruing myself all the time. Otherwise, I would not be able to awaken. I would think awakening is some attack on reality. You know, if we think this world, this forgetfulness is reality, multidimensionality seems like an attack. It seems like insanity. Really, seriously, if you were to awaken to multidimensionality, think believing that our normal functioning here in existence is reality, and this is how we're created to function, everything, you would literally think that you're going insane. That you're becoming schizophrenic, multiple personalities, you know, you're just completely flipping out, and you'd run in and for some psych, you know, you run to a mental ward and they pump you full of antipsychotics. Really. You think reality is being attacked, that it's this fragmenting, that it's being destroyed, you'd be freaking out. But if you take the spiritual path, your reaction is completely different. You'd say, oh my God, finally, thank God, I'm finally awakening to reality, to my functionality, to my true identity. I'm leaving behind this horrible hell of insanity. That's your reaction. You would embrace it. You'd weep with thankfulness and gratitude. And you'd welcome it with open arms. You know, that's what the spiritual path does. It enables you to welcome with open arms your awakening to multidimensionality. And if you don't have that spiritual path, you'll think you're having a psychotic breakdown. and you go running to the psychiatrist. And they'll say, oh boy, yeah, you're freaking out. This is bad. Here, let's take these antipsychotics. So you can't afford to let your guard down in this world. And you can't afford to buy in to the insane marketing of these tech titans misleading you, knowing they're misleading you, laughing about it, getting drunk on their power to mislead you. Okay? You know who I'm talking about. All the tech titans, those people that are lionized, you know, as the great innovators, the great bringing you all this great tech, they simply were drunk on the fact that they were misleading the world, seducing the world into forgetfulness. They're on an ego trip, an insane ego trip. You know, and they drank it in and said, wow, look at all these idiots. Look what I can sell them. Look at these glass beads I'm giving these everyone. Wow, it's incredible. Look how sleek and sexy these products are that I'm giving everyone. And they're just eating it up. What a bunch of fools. And you got to realize that these people who are selling all this stuff are simply getting off on what fools we all are. That's their enjoyment. They're looking at it saying, oh my God, what fools these people are. Ha, 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 ha. Laughing, thinking, this is, wow, I'm so much superior to those people. They're thinking how superior they are. Say, oh, I know this stuff is just junk, but these people are lapping it up. What fools. Look how rich I'm getting. That's what they're like. I tell you the truth, that's what they're like. These people that produce these shows and everything, you ask them, do you watch it? They say, are you kidding? This junk? I won't let my children watch it. I won't watch it. This is absolute junk. But these people are lapping it up. How funny. You know, they get a superiority trip on this. Okay? These smartphones, there's no app for awakening to multidimensionality. Okay? At the very best, you can use your intuition and grace of God to somehow tune into satsangs like this and make right use of it. You can always find some way to make right use of it. But that's not the purpose that they were made for. The purpose they're made for is to distract you from awakening. To fake multidimensionality. To fake it. To make you think you can have it all. You can have a separate reality and still be multidimensional. Not true. Then you really do end up with all sorts of split personalities trying to do that. Eventually, you're going to end up with tremendous split personalities thinking that's multidimensionality. It is not. All these games that young people are playing, all these, you know, on their smartphones, etc., that is actually fragmenting, causing fragmented personality. That is not multidimensionality at all. It's a counterfeit. It's counterfeit. And they will end up with severe mental problems, emotional problems, psych deterioration, all this terrible stuff, and they will end up on antipsychotics and all sorts of therapies, etc. Things will get really weird. Really, really weird. And it's not a good weirdness. Weirdness is not good. Multidimensionality is not weirdness. This world is weirdness. And all the Shakti teachings and all this energy teachings and all these technology and apps and everything, that creates intense weirdness. And eventually the weirdness is going to become too much for you and you're going to realize, oh my gosh, I'm in this nightmare of weirdness and I hate this. And you're going to panic, you know, and then bad problems. So we've been sold a bill of goods. We've been sold some glass beads. And what do? We gave up our intensity of spiritual inquiry. That's what we sacrificed. That's what we gave up. That's the price we paid. The price we paid for all of this is we gave up our spiritual focus. And that's an insane price to pay. You know, we literally paid a horrible price for it. You might think that we have all this, and gee, how nice, we didn't got all this great technology, we didn't pay hardly any price at all. Yes, we did. We played the most exorbitant price possible for it, just so these tech people could gloat about what fools we were. That's all they got out of it. A little bit of ego tickling is what they get out of it. And yet we ended up dropping our intensity, and so now we're afraid of multidimensionality. What a price we paid for that, right? I tried to alert the world to all of this, and everybody said I was nuts. I was crazy. I said, shut up. And, you know, look what happened. Exactly what I said would happen. Everyone got played for fools. We didn't need any of this stuff, really. But as it came along, I tried to make the best use of it. And some of you have too. Try to find a way. And this satsang here is the way that I've come up with. I'm able to be available here for everyone in the world. But how many people are watching it? It's not bad teaching. You know, whatever anyone wants to say, it's time well spent. I know it is, because this is coming from intuitive. I'm somehow able to bring in this multidimensional intuition and speak for it, on behalf of it, for you, here, right now, telling you this is where it's at. It's not insanity at all. It's not multiple personalities at all. It's no personality. It's no persona. It's spirit. It's being. It's essence. It's your true functionality. It's bliss. It's delight. It's freedom. It's endless riches. It's flawless, seamless weaving and tapestry and of creativity. It's heaven. It's paradise. That's what it is. You don't want to throw that away and rot in some mental institution taking antipsychotics, trying to boost the ego, just so some people can gloat how stupid you are. You don't want to do that. You don't want to prop up these straw men, straw women here who think they're so sophisticated because they're playing you off for fools. Meanwhile, you're gobbling all your medications because you think this multidimensionality is insane. It's going to fragment you or something. No, not at all. It doesn't fragment you. How can oneness be fragmented? How can seamlessness be fragmented? There's nowhere for it to be fragmented. It's seamless. And we're just talking here because this program hasn't crashed yet. It's amazing it hasn't crashed yet. How about that? Hallelujah for that. But even if it crashes, everything's already been said, right? And I hope you've listened this far, given this speaker a chance to share this. Because sometimes it takes a while to get warmed up. Takes a while to get into it. You should know that by now. These videos, maybe they start out fragmented and a little weak, but later on, if you stay with them, they get stronger and stronger and stronger as the fear is cast aside. You know, there's enormous pressure not to speak up right now because the ego's saying, oh, you're going to be crazy, you're misleading everybody, and all this stuff. Well, there you go. I've reached the limit. It says nearing recording limit. What is the recording limit? I don't know. Let me see how much I've recorded for 2 hours. And okay, 3 hours is the recording limit. We found out what the recording limit is. It's 3 hours. Awesome. That's wonderful. We're almost at 3 hours. We'll just keep going to 3 hours. Why not? This is what teaching. This is what spiritual path is all about. You know, in the past, they thought nothing of spending 3 hours on spiritual discourse. Nothing at all. They think nothing of spending 8 hours on it. You know? And so here we are spending 3 hours. Congratulations for those of you who are here. Big congratulations. Maybe I better just save this right now so I don't lose it. Okay, I will save it right now. Let's stop recording. Congratulations, everyone. Great job.